Hey everybody, welcome to The Aristocrats, the weekly series in which adventure awaits any worthy hero. But these are not those heroes. These guys are going to be going on temp adventures that nobody else in this world would touch with a 10-foot poleaxe. I'm Clay Larson, your DM. Today we've got Carl Tart, Justin Michael, and Katie Cunningham. Say hi, guys.
Hi, guys.
Hi, guys.
You don't have to say literally what I said, but...
Whatever you say, Math Master.
Math Master.
We've already started a bit where apparently I'm known as the Math Master instead of the DM today, so...
Yeah.
It's going to be a great session. Guys, thank you so much for tuning in. We got a special episode you may have watched last week and found out that we are... Oh, say, I just saw the first vote going up for Justin's alignment. That reminds me, I almost forgot this very important thing. If you're watching and want to vote along with everything, you can go to jash.com/play. You can keep watching the Twitch stream there, not Twitter, and you can vote on stuff like Justin's character's alignment, who I think he is erasing right now.
I am erasing it to put in whatever it is.
You'll never know what his character was supposed to be. So go vote there. Let me just make sure that I've got everything else I was supposed to talk about, because I'm terrible at remembering that. Great. Guys, let's meet our adventurers for today.
My name is Carl Tart, and I don't know what the hell I'm doing. But I'm supposed to say my character stuff, right?
Yeah.
My name is Tartus X. I am a halfling bard. I can sing. I have a performance skill. I have an arcana skill.
Great.
And persuasion. You will do what I say.
Great. Tartus X, our halfling bard. Justin?
Let me figure out a voice for this person.
Okay.
Or this bird person. I'm an Aracocra? Cocra?
I think it's pronounced Aracocra.
Aracocra. I'm an Aracocra named Squeak, or the Mighty Squeak. I'm a 5'2" yellow bird with magenta feet and an eye patch who hates dinosaurs. My eye was taken by a triceratops whose butt I sliced off and keep in my person. I'm very intimidating.
I'm scared.
This character is 100% really from... I think it's the new book, right? Sword Coast Legend, or Sword Coast Companion. But yep, all real D&D stuff, you can be a birdman. Katie?
My name's Katie Cunningham, but my character is Chipper Sugar Socks. I can't keep up that voice the whole time. I escaped like a really bad marriage with an evil elf, so I'm just here trying to meet new people. I have really high charisma and very low strength. My name's Chipper.
Great. And Chipper is an elf cleric, in case you were wondering. Guys, that's it. Let's get started. Are we still waiting on the vote for Justin's alignment?
Lawful evil.
Lawful
evil. Oh my
evil.
God.
A lawful evil birdman.
Great.
Named Squeak. Great. So, we're going to get started, guys, and we voted at the end of last episode for the adventure we'd be going on, which was between two user-submitted adventures. If you hang around till the end of the show, or maybe we'll throw it up now, I'm not controlling what goes up link-wise, but we've got a Google form where you can actually submit adventures for people to go on, and this adventure was submitted by Bum Bum Party on Twitch.tv. So if this goes off the rails, it's Bum Bum Party's fault and not mine.
Oh, Bum Bum.
Oh, Bum Bum Party.
What a bum bummer.
Oh, ding ding ding.
Wow.
Each joke requires a sip of water.
Yeah.
That's how you replenish
I'm
it.
I'm thirsty.
Yeah.
That was so funny.
I know.
All right, guys, let's get started. You guys find yourself in the city of Calmstone, waiting in the waiting room in the offices of Tavlin's Temporium LLC, an adventurer's temp agency. You guys are all adventurers who maybe couldn't get normal work recently, so you went to a temp agency to, you know, make ends meet. You guys are in this office area. It's kind of like white walls, cheap chairs. There's some like old motivational posters on the wall. There's a cheap coffee on a table in one corner. And there is a receptionist at the front, Betsy, a middle-aged human lady who seems a little over this job, but that's what's going on here right now. You guys want to check anything out or do anything? You're waiting for someone to come out and give you your job.
I want to cheer up the receptionist.
Okay. So you want to talk to Betsy? What do you say to her?
Hey there, why the long face? My name's Chipper. It's my name.
Devlin will be out in any moment. Please take a seat and wait. You get the idea that she is very much going off of, like, the stuff she says my rote a lot.
Ooh, I noticed that she's, like, just stuck in a dead-end job, and I want to go talk to her.
Okay.
Hello there, Betsy. How's it going?
It's fine. How are you?
Fine or horrible?
What?
Rise, Betsy. Rise above this job. Quit your job. Set this place on fire and leave.
Okay, sir. Please take a seat.
Rise, Betsy!
She kind of, like, rears back a little and goes back to her magazine.
I'm Squeak.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Squeak.
Think about it.
Think about what?
Think about rising.
I'm not going to rise, whatever that
is. Just think about it.
All right. Okay. Want to talk to Betsy anymore?
Yes. I want to talk to Betsy. My name is Tartus X, and I am a halfling bard. And this job is holding you back, Betsy.
Yes.
You have been hoodwinked, bamboozled,
right.
Run amok. Betsy, I am Tartus X from the land of Fetty Wap.
Great.
I am a singer. You should do exactly what this bird, Squeak, has told you to do,
yes.
Betsy.
Betsy, your job reminds me of my dad marriage.
Rise, Betsy.
Betsy stands up.
Thank you, Betsy.
She says, this is the second week in a row that you people, she's referring to people who just work in the office.
What do you mean by you people?
You adventurers have tried to get me to quit my job.
What else?
No, not elves specifically.
Bird people with eye patches.
There's never been a bird person in here.
But... Halfling bards that come from the land of Fetty Wap.
Now, where is Fetty Wap?
Far, far away.
Right near Dribble Drop.
Mm. And just south of the Bird People Mountains.
Look, Tavlin will be out with your job any moment. Please have a seat. I'm not going to quit, all right?
Kind of ruffle my feathers and, like, stand as tall as I can for a 5'2" tall bird.
Uh-huh.
Can I try to intimidate her into rising against
you
her job?
You can try to intimidate her into quitting.
Okay, just to be, just FYI, I have horrible charisma.
Right.
Cool, so do I just roll for it?
Yep, roll your d20.
So I rolled a 1. Not a natural 1, just a regular 1.
Okay, you molt. A little. Her insistence on not rising up is enough that your feathers are dropping a little bit.
My precious feathers.
And she says, sir, please stop molting on the Temporium's floor. I have to clean that up. That's making my job worse. Mm. You realize that, right?
Why is that in your job description as a receptionist? You shouldn't have to clean up his molt. I would like to try to challenge her to quit her job. My charisma is very high.
So you're that would be a persuasion check? So go ahead and roll a d20.
This one.
Yes.
I rolled a 9.
Okay, so you're going to add 5 to this, so 14.
Oh, no, wait.
No,
I rolled a 6, but then I put
so it's a 12.
Two more. So, regardless. Okay, so she kind of looks and he says, I thank you for your concern, Tardis X.
Thank you, sister.
I'd love to hear you sing sometime, but I really can't quit, all right?
All right.
I'm in a contract, and also, Tavlin has been very good to me, despite what it seems.
Not if you clean it up, moat birds. On the floor.
We actually don't get that many Arakakoa.
Arakakra!
Or Arakakra in here.
Can Chipper convince Betsy to a girls' night?
We don't want to go on an adventure. We want to talk to Betsy for hours.
What do you want to do? You want to convince her to, like, hang out with you? Like,
yeah. Just,
okay.
Go dancing.
Sure. Go ahead and roll a persuasion check.
How do I? Which one do I do?
D20.
This one? Seven.
So that's going to be 12. So what do you say to her?
Hey, Betsy, I know this after hours. It's really good for single ladies and elves alike. Do you want to get crazy?
When? Tonight? Or tomorrow night? Or this weekend?
Tonight.
I mean, I can't do tonight.
Betsy, why?
Because I have plans.
What are your plans?
I have a date.
Ooh, oh, what? Betsy, wow. Hey, girl.
Where are you going on a date, Betsy?
With one of the adventurers from last week.
Where is he taking you?
He's taking me to a ramen place.
You can do better. Rise. Rise above the ramen.
Ramen is always too much broth and not enough noodles.
Yes.
And it's super cheap.
Super cheap.
Well, it's a first date.
All right, yeah.
It's a first date, all right? Listen, if you want to wait and go to this dance next weekend, I can maybe do that.
It's not a dance, Betsy. We're adults.
What's this venue called?
It's called Woogie.
Ooh, I've got a show there.
I love Woogie.
Woogie? Great. So as this is going on, you guys are having your conversation with Betsy, and the door to the office opens, and a fat little gnome comes out.
Yeah. Oh, I love this.
And you know that this is Tavlin Crownbottom, the proprietor of Tavlin's Temporium, LLC. And he comes out and he's got his, like, nice, fine robes on with a hood over his head, and he's carrying a folder. And he comes out and says, "Good morning, adventurers! Do you hear that? Do you?"
I don't hear a thing.
"It's the call of adventure! For you! To do for pay! Yes, yes! Now, let's see what we have for you today." And he kind of starts going through his folder of papers, and he says, "Hey, it seems that we have a request from a Dr. Scorch Longwhistle, DDM.
That's my ex-husband.
Really? You're the ex Mrs. Longwhistle?
Yes.
Well, this is going to be awkward. Apparently, a mysterious man has been hanging around his residence at night, and he needs your help to protect his home from this sinister figure."
Okay.
He's contracted out 3 adventurers to help determine the nature of this mystery. Due to the nighttime nature of this job, normally you would have to finish by closing time at 5 p.m., but you can finish by the morning in order to deal with this mysterious figure, whoever he may be. The doctor's address, well, you probably already know this, is 10 Twin Pond Road, over in the nice part of town.
Oh, God, I know.
The nice part of town? What's that supposed to mean?
It's kind of like the upper middle class section of a suburb area, of course.
This dude is a DDM?
Yes.
That means he's a dentist.
Yes!
I bet he lives next door to a whole bunch of hard-working celebrity halfling bards doing their jobs, struggling for pay, and doing everything they can do to live in that type of neighborhood and make a better life for their children, and he's a damn dentist.
He's got a hot tub the size of a pool.
That's a damn shame.
Well, I don't really know anything about that.
Yeah, you're gonna find out. Let's get on this adventure, y'all.
Yes.
Let's get on it.
Let's repair to your ex-husband's abode.
Luckily, I'm over it. And I'm really charismatic.
So, you guys want to just head out? You have no other questions or anything?
Does he operate on dinosaurs?
I don't believe anyone operates or performs dentistry on dinosaurs in Calmstone.
Interesting. I've become less interested in this journey.
How much are we getting paid?
Yes, how much are we getting paid? Good question.
Well, let's see. The pay is variable on if you complete the job or not.
That didn't answer how much.
Well,
entirely.
Upon successful completion of the job, you'll each earn 15 gold. Although there is wiggle room depending on how you complete the job. Once his magical temp agency contract is marked as fulfilled, the money will be forwarded to your accounts.
Do I get more money for the emotional difficulty?
No!
Do I get more money for her emotional difficulty?
Why would you ever get that?
Because I'm trying everything I can to get more money.
We love money.
Didn't you know the three of us love money?
Love it.
Love it, money, money.
Oh,
love
money's so it. Good.
That song was on my third album.
You should listen to it. It's great.
I will go and look it up. What's the name of the album?
It's titled Money. Love money.
And it's that the was third track?
Third track on the third album.
Okay. What was the first two album names?
I'll tell you later.
One was called Gold Gold.
Gold Gold and Money Money. Okay.
I like themes.
I'm a huge fan. Huge fan.
Yes, honestly, huge fan. We couldn't be more humbled to be in your midst.
Thank you so much. As we all get a job at a gym agency.
Great. Do you guys want to head out?
Yeah, let's do this.
So, you leave town with Temporium. The nice part of town, you guys all have been around the city, your characters have, so they know kind of what area. You know where, what was the address I said? 10 Twin Pond Road is. So you can head directly there if you want. You can really go anywhere in town if you want to, like, have any other errands you want to run. But
maybe we
there
should.
There is a bit of a, you know, there is, like, obviously a time limit on this. Like, you got to finish by tomorrow morning. And
I need a new outfit.
You need a new outfit.
Where's the best place to get a new outfit? Before I leave, I ask that.
Who do you ask?
Betsy.
Probably somewhere in the market district.
Okay.
I don't frequent all the hot shops.
Put some clothes on, by the way.
Betsy, I need something
I'm wearing
slutty.
Clothes.
You are naked-minded. Your mind is nude. Because if it was clothed, you would have quit this job a long time ago. That moat is starting to stick to the floor.
Nice.
All right. Well, I'll think about that.
Betsy, why do you talk like you're so old, but you're young?
Smokers, I'm not that young.
You're 36.
You're young.
You don't know that.
You have a sign that says, I'm 36. Sitting in the window, we know you're 36.
I asked Tavlin not to put that up.
And you want to work for this man, this gnome.
Talon's gone back in his back office, by the way, so he doesn't know you guys are saying this.
Good. Let this seep into your pores. Rise.
Oh, I'm gonna go get the mop for your molt.
You could probably just use a broom.
He said it's starting to stick.
Oh.
She's gonna need some pine saw for that molt.
So do you guys head out?
Let's hit the shops.
Let's hit the shops and shop.
Haberdashery.
A haberdashery?
Halfling bardashery.
I want to go to an eye patch store.
So you guys, it sounds like you want to go to the market district instead of starting your job. Cool.
Gotta look good before you do evil.
So the market district is kind of in the center of Calmstone. It's kind of the big plaza that has a lot of different, more pop-up stalls that have different vendors and like smaller, like not brick and mortar type shops, but like tents and stuff. And then around the edge of the plaza, there's a little more established, that's where the more established like brick and mortar type buildings would be, where there are permanent shops. So you could go anywhere in there. Is there anything specific you guys are looking for?
I'm looking for something sassy.
Something sassy?
Yet like comfortable because I need to do an adventure.
Okay. Are you going to put that... Well, you can look for different stuff. So you could probably look around the market district and try to find something that appeals to that. Or you could go to one of the brick and mortar type stores that... There's a few, I guess, what we would call department-type stores, and then a few other, like, smaller boutique clothing stores?
I think the highest boutique, highest end.
Okay.
Is this how much money I have right here?
Yeah. And then, are you guys just following her, or are you looking for your own?
I mean, I'm keeping it one eye out, as I do have an eye patch for some decorative eye patch things. Some
decorative eye patches, okay.
Yes.
You'd probably look around, like, the, what do I call these? The tent?
The pop-ups.
The pop-ups.
Yes, I like pop-ups. They're a good sign of gentrification.
I love pop-ups, too. It's there and then it isn't.
So you're looking for
the most gentrified eye patch store.
Okay.
I'm just walking with them now.
Okay.
But if I see something I like, I will purchase.
Cool. Yeah. So why don't we do this? Katie, Chipper is going off to like a boutique store to try on sassy dresses. I assume, is that what you're looking for?
Yeah. Or a pantsuit.
Or a pantsuit. Great. But also, just make note, right now you guys are all wearing armor. To put on a pantsuit, it might be hard to find a pantsuit. I guess you could put on
a
leather armor.
A short dress with my armor.
You could either put on the armor over that or get a dress much too big for you to put on over your armor. I'll leave that to you. Justin, you're walking around the stalls. So you guys are splitting up a little bit. Are you going with one or...
I'll go look off on my own.
Okay, cool. Yeah. So why don't you each roll a d20?
Oh,
and
shoot.
This is, we'll say this is all on the investigation check. So I don't think any of you are trained in that. But that is, you're going to add in your intelligence modifier.
So I have 21.
21. Mm-hmm. Great.
11.
11.
19.
19. Okay, so we'll start at the lowest. So Justin, you don't really find anything that is a real eye patch. And then talking to people, like you just seem to not be hitting the shops where you're finding anything. You do find a place that has a number of decorative bandanas that you could use as a makeshift eye patch if you want. They're like 10 coppers each.
Who's running this store?
It's just a young human.
You, young human.
Think about if you're gonna buy it or not. We'll come back because I want to let everybody know.
Yes.
Katie, you go into this boutique and you're able to find some nice options. You actually find a dress you like. It is kind of expensive because these are higher end boutiques.
Yeah.
So that's gonna be like for this dress, it would probably be like 8 gold.
So I won't have a lot of money left.
Right. So you can think about if you want to buy it or not, because it's a high end boutique, but it's a very nice dress. And then Carl, you rolled really well. Pick something that you would, like, you find something you would be interested in. Give me some ideas of what that might be.
A very nice mink coat.
A very nice mink coat.
Full length.
Great.
With a hat.
Great. So you find in one of the stalls that's it's secondhand clothes, because mink's normally kind of expensive, but you find one in like a secondhand type stall that looks pretty nice and not too overused, and it's only 3 gold.
Okay.
So, wow.
Yeah.
Does it come with a hat?
No, it doesn't come with a hat. There is a hat that you think could go with it, but that's another gold.
So for 4 gold, I could get a floor length, nice mink coat, and a mink hat.
Yeah.
I'm in.
That's great. A good deal.
Is it floor length until
it's floor length for a halfling. Like for a human or an it would be like a regular length.
Oh, okay.
But for a halfling it's floor length.
Just dragging it across wherever you go.
So
yes, I'm in. How tall is this dude? 5'2"?
Shorter than that. He's 3'6".
Such a tiny little man.
So you're buying your fat. So go ahead and like mark that you have 4 less gold. What about you guys?
I'm gonna buy that dress.
Okay. You have 2 gold left, I believe, right?
This is probably a bad decision.
No, you're visiting. I'm not there.
And we'll say
your ex-husband.
Oh yeah, I got it. Look good.
Yeah.
And Katie, I'll let you decide. Do you want the one that would fit, or you could wear one that fits nicely and take off your armor? It's gonna make you like more of a target if there is a fight of any
I'll
kind?
I'll just wear my armor over it.
Okay,
like,
cool.
You
so
know.
You're getting a form-fitting one, putting your armor over it.
Yes.
Great. Love it. And then a sassy form-fitting dress with leather armor over it. And then, Justin, are you going to buy some...
A bandana?
Yeah.
Well, I already do have an eye patch.
There is a variety of patterns.
Ooh, do tell me. What is the most intimidating pattern you
paisley?
Have?
Paisley?
The most intimidating? I don't know if I'd call paisley the most intimidating. There's one that has, like, what seems to be art of cartoon. It's not, like, real like, intimidating skulls, but it's, like, cartoon skulls.
Oh, creepy.
But, like, imagine, you remember that old, like, 1940s cartoon with the dancing skeletons?
Yes.
They're, like, smiling? It's those kind of skulls.
I'll buy it.
Okay.
I'll buy three of them.
Three of them?
That's yes.
30 yeah, that's
one
scary.
For each of us.
That's scary.
It's yeah. like the skulls at the end of the Jackson's torture video, where they were dancing.
Always yeah. scary.
So you buy three smiling cartoon skull bandanas.
Great.
And I look sassy.
You do look sassy. Great. So you guys had your market trip. It's now like 11 in the morning. It was about 9 when you were at the office and got your job, and you went in. So yeah, it's around 11. It's getting, you know, by the time you would get to 10, I keep forgetting the address I created 10 and made up.
10 Twin Pine Road.
10 Twin Pine Road. By the time you get there, it'd probably be like noon. So you just want to head there? Do you want to do something else?
Before we head there, I just want to give you guys...
I want to give you these. I bought a bandana for each of you. They have intimidating skulls on them.
Oh, I'm going to wear it as a little neck scarf.
Cool.
Oh. I'll do the same thing because I am wearing a full-length bandana and hat. How cold is it in Kongstone?
It is it's like 68 right now.
Oh, damn. This main coat's going to get rough. It's not, but I'm going to keep it on.
Yeah.
Because you got to look fly.
I mean, 4 gold, that's a great deal.
Mm-hmm. How many intruders must die for me to look fly?
I'll take a sip of water.
Great. So what do you guys do?
Should we go?
Yes.
Yeah, I'm mentally preparing. Just practicing my mantras.
Do you want to fill these guys in at all on, like, what anything about your relationship with Dr. Scorch Longwhistle?
Well, Scorch and I, you know, we started off strong, but then, you know, things got a little crazy once he started dating a merman.
A merman? Okay, great. So your middle-aged gnome husband was dating a merman.
Who's a dentist.
Who's a dentist. Great. Yeah,
Dentist that... really looking outside his comfort zone.
Listen.
So he was a closeted gay man.
To me, that sounds like a textbook midlife crisis.
Is his first name really Scorch? Is that legally his first name?
It's Eugene.
Oh. It's Eugene. How did you know that?
That's so much more of a dentist name. I buy that.
His real name's Eugene, but he goes by Scorch.
What a cool guy. I like him.
So, are you telling them this while you're on your way to the place?
Or? Yeah.
Okay. An hour for us to get.
So, yeah, it's like you're wandering. You don't seem to be in a rush. So you get there, you're outside. It's like a nice, modest 2-story brownstone in this kind of high, upper middle class suburb section of town. So what do you guys want to do? You want to just go up and knock on the door?
No. I know the entrance to the back patio.
Okay.
So I'm going to sneak in that way.
You want to sneak in? Okay, great. Are you guys going with her?
Yes.
Okay. Great. So you get to the back porch. And there is a door there. Do you want to try and open it?
Yeah.
Okay. are you trying to still be stealthy and, like, sneak in?
Yeah.
Okay. I think so. So you're going to roll a stealth check. So that's a d20, and you're going to add your dexterity modifier.
19 plus
3. Wow. All right. So yeah, you are able to open the door with no, like, it doesn't squeak or anything. It was unlocked.
Oh, you know this house.
Yeah.
Stealthy.
It's very quietly open. Are you all going in?
Oh, yeah. Yes. I wouldn't sit on the sidelines for this.
Okay. So... She rolled a 23. That's good to all open the door and, like, walk in. You guys also need to roll stealth checks to go in. So go ahead and roll a d20 as your dexterity modifier.
19.
19? Great.
Damn.
nine.
Nine? Okay. So you guys are pretty quiet.
I fart. I really have to go to the bathroom.
The coat, like, fly up a little bit?
Yeah. The mink coat, just like, it's not, like, cartoonishly big, but it does. If someone was behind you, you'd see a little ripple.
Yeah.
I am behind him.
Yeah. And it's loud enough, and you hear someone rustle and, like, move around in the front room.
Damn it.
Yes, I really gotta go to the bathroom.
Silence your butt.
Butt silenced.
And then all of a sudden, there's a, like, a head pops in through the door and says, "Hello, is anyone back there? Hello?" And you hear footsteps and someone's walking back.
Oh, fuck.
I'll subdue him if I need to.
Wait, there's a trap door in the garden.
Okay. You know this house, there's a trapdoor in the garden. I don't know why there's a trapdoor in the garden.
Where's the nearest bathroom?
Is there a bathroom in the garden?
Is there a bathroom at this level of the house where I can
Yeah, we have an out. We have an out.
All right, well, you guys just asked about the bathroom, because this is all happening in real time. All of a sudden, this guy walks out. And it's a little gnome. Where he walks out while a halfling in a mink coat is asking about the bathroom and mink hat to his apparently ex-wife, Elf, and a birdman.
I just fly at him and, like, try to slam him against a wall.
Okay.
I just go, "I'm not who you think I am."
So you're going to try and slam him
Yeah, just, like, kind of pin him against a wall.
So roll an attack roll.
Just strength.
Uh-huh.
20.
20. All right, you pin him against the wall.
Caw!
And he goes, "Why? What? Chipper, is that you?
No.
Who are you?"
"I am Squeak, dinosaur hunter. And we are the three skulls. And you are subdued, Eugene."
"Eugene? Did you tell him my real name?"
"What?
We know everything about you, about the garden and the outhouse."
"That's not everything."
"Well, we know two things."
"Two things. And I am Tardis X, R&B singer from the land of Fetty Wap."
"What does R&B stand for?"
"Rhythm and Bard."
Take a sip.
What? "Why are you here? Why are you three here?"
"I forget."
"Oh, we come here to help you. Yeah, don't yell at us."
"What?
We've come to help you."
"What?
There's an intruder somewhere around your house. You call the temp agency for this."
"You're from the temp agency."
"You know, yes. I know this is awkward, but I'm the best in the business. Where's that merman?"
"Charles and I are not together anymore."
"Oh?
Oh, rise."
"Also, why did he try to sneak in this house like it was nighttime? 12 noon.
Why? If you're not from the temp agency, why didn't you just knock on the front door? I hired
the
you."
"The intruder might have been out there."
"Yeah.
He's definitely case in
point." "I specifically said when I hired you from Tablins that he only shows up at 10 p.m. every night."
"You said that?"
"Yes."
"I wanted to feel like a Bond girl."
"Oh, Chip, this is why things never worked out."
"Because I always wanted to be a Bond girl?"
"Because you were too impulsive.
We put a lot of trust
That's
in her.
That's true.
She said she knew you."
"Well, yeah, she said she knew you."
"She may have known me once. Anyway, come into the front room."
"Is that a toupee?"
"No! Right. No, it's not a toupee!"
"It looks like a toupee."
"I know it looks like a toupee, but it's not.
It's his real
it
hair."
His real hair looks like the straw from a broom.
Oh,
yuck.
So he invites you, he kind of motions for you to follow him into the front room to talk about the case.
"When I looked at your hair, that's when I knew I was in love."
"You never told me that."
"I love your weird hair."
Oh, he's kind of like, that helped him get over the, ridiculously early in the day intrusion in his home. But he kind of motions you guys to the cut of the front room, and he'll explain the job. But before he does that, we're going to take a quick break. We'll be right back. Do we have a vote going up for them? Oh, so if you want to vote on if these guys are going to actually succeed on this quest, that they, if you're just joining us, their quest is to help this man that they just intruded on a home find out why there's a man watching his home every night at 10 p.m. And before going to help him, they went to the market to get clothes. So that's your details.
We look good.
They do look good. He's wearing a big coat.
So, and a hat.
Take that into consideration when you're voting on if they can
I have
succeed.
No money left, but I'm great.
You can vote if you're watching on twitch.tv. You can go to jash.com/play, continue watching the Twitch stream, and vote there. We'll be right back, guys, with the Aristocrats. Thanks for watching. Hey, guys, welcome back to the Aristocrats. We're here with Carl Tart, Justin Michael, and Katie Cunningham. We have been going on a quest, in case you're just joining us or need to be filled in, where these guys have been called to help someone who has a mysterious stranger who's watching his house every night at 10 p.m. This is actually a user-submitted adventure from Bum Bum Party. I'm going to say Bum Bum Party so many times.
Please
today.
Do.
Bum Bum.
And if you want to play along and vote on stuff as we're doing this, you can go to jash.com/play, and we actually just got one of the votes back. We asked you guys during the break if you think that they are going to succeed in this quest, and it sounds like, from what the producers have told me, you do. I don't know if I agree or not, but we'll see.
I think we've been very efficient so far. We've gone shopping.
Now that we're back from the break, though, before we jump back into the game, I always like to ask people, like, when we get back, just we'll go down the line, what kind of, like, what's your real life experience with D&D, like if you have played, tell us about that. Or if you never played, like what did you think D&D was before playing?
I've never played. Mm-hmm. I've only watched it on like 80s documentaries and stuff like that. And I thought it was like Magic the Gathering. There was these kids who used to hang out in between the, in my high school, I went to high school in this area, actually. And there was two big buildings, and there were kids who hung out in between the two big buildings just playing Magic the Gathering the whole time. And that's what I thought it was like.
So you thought like it was like cards.
Which I also don't know how to play that either.
Right, right.
Or, like, no diss to it. I feel like it's always, I mean, whatever makes people happy, I'm all for.
Yeah.
All
so. That's interesting, yeah. Because, yeah, like, if you haven't, like, seen it, like, why would you know that it's, like, kind of, like, improv and stuff like that?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Cool. Justin?
I played it once in, like, middle school or early high school with, like, a group of people I didn't really know, and it kind of sucked. So I didn't play until, like, after college with you.
What? Real fast, why did it suck when you played it in...
I think like the DM was trying to kill us more than like have fun, and right. It was like really like I like playing with bits more than I like playing with, like, I still like the rules to be intact, but I want to like be able to try to do things that are fun rather than be told I can't do things the entire time.
Yeah.
And I feel like it was that sort of game. And then when I started playing after college, I played 4th edition, and I had fun but did not understand the math of it. And it wasn't until this version of it that I started to figure it out.
Right. Yeah, and in case anybody's wondering who's watching, we're playing basically a hacked version of 5th edition, just to keep, like, as we go on, if you know D&D, you might see, like, we're missing a few rules. That's just to keep things rolling for camera and make it easier for people who haven't played. Cool. Very cool. Yeah. Katie?
I had never played before, and I thought there was like a board game involved.
Uh-huh.
I thought it was like a giant board game.
Oh,
I don't
really?
Know why, from no information. But yeah, I've just seen it like referenced in TV shows. So
right.
I had a rough idea.
There actually are, some people play D&D with like when you guys are moving around, like if you get in a fight, there's like a little map with like
figures.
Oh,
maybe that's what I'm
that
thinking.
May have where you got that impression.
Yes.
We don't do that just for camera. It's easier to have it be all in your mind.
Who is this? Math Master?
Oh, Math Master!
Math Master's back! Hello, math master.
In case you are just joining us,
he'll do the math.
Somehow this bit started where instead of being a dungeon master, I'm a math master. So I guess we're rolling with that now.
Literally.
We're rolling.
Let's get back into it. So,
I won't sip anymore.
In case you were just joining us, where we're at now is they went to the location of their quest to meet Dr. Scorch Longwhistle, DDM, who they're supposed to be helping, who, and we have found out, is also Chipper Sugar Socks. That was it, right? Chipper Sugar Socks?
It's purposefully hard to say.
Is her ex-husband. And instead of just walking up to the door and knocking on it, they snuck in the back. However, things have calmed down a bit. He brought you in. So now he's telling you about, like, what's going on. You guys are in the front room, which is kind of homey. There's some benches and pillows.
Any of these yours?
Yeah, I stitched that pillow.
That's nice.
Benches and pillows?
That's kind of in the foyer, which, like, leads into the living room, I guess you would call it, which has, like, couches.
Couches.
A piano.
A white
stuff
couch
like that.
With a white piano.
A white couch with a white piano.
Fancy.
This pillow says, "I love our heterosexual marriage."
And that's also a very specific pillow.
As he brings you in, he picks up a cat and he kind of says, this is Delanor. Mutton chops around here somewhere else. Who knows with that one? But yes, welcome you two to the home. Welcome back, Chipper.
Hi.
So, anyway, this fellow, he's been outside my house staring in from under the street lamp in front. He's always wearing a long coat, and his face is shrouded in some sort of mask with a symbol on it. That's really all I know. Every time I run outside to chase him off, he's not there by the time I get to the street lamp. He's like he just disappears in thin air. It's very odd, very odd. So anyway, I'd like you to investigate. The cats go absolutely mad whenever they see him, and I can't sleep because they go insane.
What are your cats' names again?
Delanor and Mutton Chop.
Delanor and Mutton Chop.
Franklin, how I've missed them.
Yes. Huh? Franklin Roosevelt. I don't know anything.
Franklin Delano Roosevelt.
A dwarven warrior with...
Oh, yes.
So if you're not seeing Merman, are you seeing someone new?
This is really not the time or place or company to have this conversation.
Well,
make
right?
sure
saying.
That cat doesn't get close to me. I'm a very small man, and he looks like a large tiger next to me. And I'm wearing a mink. I don't want any extra hair on this mink. This isn't a cat.
Don't let them touch
jacket.
My dress.
He's holding Delanor, which is like a tabby, kind of a big, chubby tabby. And the cat does seem interested in that mink coat, but he's not letting go of it.
Cat is huge.
I am suspicious of this cat.
Okay.
Can I investigate anything? Is there anything or percept?
Anything? I think the cat is the man under the street.
The cat's a little man.
I know that's not true, but I feel it. I feel.
So Justin, roll an investigate check on the cat.
Great, I have a -2 to that. Ooh, natural 20.
Okay. As far as you can tell, the cat's a cat.
All right, this cat is a cat, and you knew that already.
Yeah, I just wanted you to.
Also, because you rolled a natural 20, you can tell that this cat in particular is very friendly, like, for a cat. It's not standoffish. The other cat he mentioned, Mutton Chop, isn't around right now. You know, it's a cat. It's probably somewhere else.
What does Mutton Chop look like?
Hairless.
Also, his ironic name.
Mutton Chop, yes, is a hairless cat.
Ugh.
He's really fat.
He's a fat, hairless cat. We try not to talk about it around him. Not that he understands, but it just feels mean.
It's like a seal.
Yes.
I don't know about a seal, but...
Sounds like a seal. A big, fat, hairless cat. That's kind of a mammal. A seal could be if it went
anyway,
in water.
It's like a baby seal.
Could we please stop talking about my fat cat? And please, I want you to investigate this man.
Got it. Right.
So well, appears... did you and the merman end on bad terms? Could it be the merman?
I'm not talking about Charlie with you, okay, Chipper?
Charlie.
Fine, I'll let it go.
Oh, this, I relish this.
Yeah.
Yes. So what do you guys do now? Do you want to ask him anything else?
Yeah. I want to ask him Why do you leave your house at night when you see a strange man outside? Stay inside.
Well, I want to chase him off.
No, God.
I'm not a coward.
Well, it worked. Now you don't know where he is or who he is. He's still lurking in the shadows. Just stay in the house.
Should have stayed in the house.
And you got us coming out here.
Yeah, because when you walk fast, it looks like a waddle because you're a gnome. And you're
okay, mixed. Come on.
I'll tell you one thing. If I didn't find this mink coat and matching hat, I would not be happy about coming out here.
Yes.
But this has been a fruitful trip.
If I wasn't wearing Dolce & Gabbana, I might not be as happy either.
And if I wasn't wearing a bandana with cartoon skulls on it, what they said.
Well, I'm glad that you're all happy, but what are you going to do about this?
All right. Well, first we need a room to camp out in.
You need a room?
Is there an extra room in here? Yes. We might have to stay a few days.
A few days?
Yes, the finest man.
Oh, you think we'll just do it overnight, do you?
Oh, wait, we have to.
Oh, yeah. Yes. Oh, yes, the job.
The contract specifically states that, I mean, they even gave you an extension.
Yes,
because
okay.
It's been a long day, so we'll need to take a nap.
We like money.
You're going to take a nap?
Yes, and he don't come until 10. It's what, 12:45?
Do you want to look around or anything?
We need to go in the hot tub to brainstorm.
Oh, I bet you'd like to go in the hot tub.
Yes, we would.
It's the size of a pool.
Listen.
That's a hot pool.
It's a hot pool.
Listen, I don't mind giving you a room, the guest room to work out of, but don't you feel, I guess you can wait until he just shows up. Do you not want to investigate at all?
I think perhaps we should investigate and set a trap for this mysterious figure.
Yeah. Right.
That's the kind of go-to-itiveness that I'm paying for.
Yes, I'm a good guy.
Thank you, sir.
I'm a good elf.
I'm a bird. Oh, shoot.
Well, let's set up a trap by the light post.
Okay.
But if he's watching it, we have to find out a way to set this trap stealthily.
Okay.
Now, I can fly, so I can kind of, if we want, I can be watching from above. But
you
I
can't
also,
fly.
I do not have dark vision.
I could maybe, like, make water appear on him when the time comes.
Oh, yes, with your spell, create or destroy water.
I mean, I say if it's that other cat transformed into a human, cats hate water.
Yeah. If it's a cat, I got this.
And I'm okay. Naturally stiff.
I will solve this.
Well, so you're not, so it's like now like 1:30-ish, so you still got a little bit of time to plan and what you want to do. You guys are still in the living room area? Like, what do you want to do? Do you want to...
I kind of want to scope out the house, just, like, see if there's anything that seems unusual or, like, you know,
okay.
Like, anybody's entered or, like, gotten in there without him knowing, without Eugene Scorch Long Whistle knowing.
Because if I hadn't farted, he would have never known that he came
yeah.
in the back door. So this
That's
dude
true.
Might not be the most...
That's
observant.
True. He's a dentist, so... all right, so you're exploring... You want to explore the whole house?
Yeah, maybe start with the living room and then just see what else there is.
Okay, we'll say to do that, you're going to roll an invest. You're each, because I assume you all are scoping it out.
Yeah, well, I know where stuff is. I'm going to get a box of some stuff.
You're going to get a box? All right.
I'll scope.
All right, so you guys are looking. Are you also, you're like, looking at, are you like looking for anything like that looks unfamiliar, out of place, or are you just, you can do something else if you want.
Well, I'm looking for my box of stuff and then evidence of like a new person that lives there.
Okay.
And be like, is it a man or a woman?
Great. So this is, because it's, you know, a two-story brownstone. It's not huge, but we'll say to like really investigate, it'll take about 2 hours, like,
jeez,
to really look around.
Okay.
Can we have snacks while we...
If you find snacks, yes.
I just eat pellets, so that's okay.
But we're going to do one investigate check for all of that.
Investigate the kitchen first.
This is for the whole house. So everybody just roll an investigate check.
For the 20?
Yeah.
Just, oh yeah, d20.
And INT?
Yes.
Oh, three plus five.
So 8, all right.
No, 3 plus 2.
Oh, 5.
14.
14, okay.
Wait, 19, and then what are we adding it to?
This one.
Minus
1. 1, yeah.
Okay, 18.
18, 14, and 8. So, again, what was that?
5.
5, sorry. So TARDIS X finds nothing that he can make any like guesses about or anything. Like he basically like gets distracted by the you guys do find some like some nice breaded like a hard bread type chips and some cheese.
Ooh, sounds good.
Hard
bread type chips.
I don't know what those are called. Not, like,
pita chips?
Like a pita chip.
I'm not thinking of a pita chip. I'm thinking of maybe that's
I know what you're talking about.
Like those fancy
like what you use on like bruschetta.
Yeah, like those sorts of chips. Right. But anyways, you
this
find
is
that
where
some
we
cheese,
keep the hot
and you
kind of
like get distracted by that. It's good. You like it.
And then that cat starts coming at me.
Asa crackers. Awesome.
Asa crackers. Yeah, like Asa crackers.
I crumble them and throw them on the ground and then eat them from the ground.
So Carl is really, or not Carl, TARDIS is really obsessed with that. So you don't really like find anything else.
Nom nom nom.
Squeak is able to notice there is like at a window upstairs. You notice that one of the latches seems to be busted.
Okay.
And then you, because you're familiar with the house, you actually kind of get a bit of a bonus. You actually notice, and you do, you roll well enough, you do find a box of some of your stuff. It's nothing, anything major, but like, it's, you know, like some books, some, maybe some makeup supplies, like that sort of standard stuff that is easy to forget behind after a breakup. But you do find a box of that. The box is labeled Harpy. So.
Whoa.
I'm. It's an emotionally high time for me.
Yeah.
Me and this
we are separate.
My heart.
Clearly, he was not pleased when he made that box of like all your
he
stuff.
He never uses the word harpy, so he doesn't use that lately.
Yeah. And that's like a bigger deal in this world because harpies are real things that you could fight and they're terrifying.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
I'm offended with that information.
Using it as a slur.
Yeah.
With that new information.
So you find that, but you also notice, so there's that piano in the front room.
White.
That white piano. And it's sort of like if you imagine the room, like you walk in, the piano's against one wall, and then against this wall it's like piano, and then a few feet, and then the stairs go up to the second floor. And the side that's facing the stairs, on one of the corners, there's like a big dent that you know was not there. That like was in pristine condition when you were living here.
So I want to investigate that dent.
In the investigation check you did, like because it took 2 hours, like that you notice that it's a big dent. You can't really tell what made, like anything could have made a dent in something.
Mm-hmm.
But that is definitely wasn't there the last time you saw that piano.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so that's you guys find the dent, the broken latch, and Asa crackers.
Did I find any like dinosaur teeth or anything? He's
nope.
A dentist.
Trust me, I would tell you if you found dinosaur teeth.
All right, still looking. Mm-hmm. That's my thing.
I know.
He loves
You're a bird man who hunts dinosaurs.
Yeah, squeak.
Crackers are delicious.
Yum.
He's Asa cracker.
So, So it's around like 3-ish now.
TARDIS X, what did you find?
Oh, well, I gotta be honest with you. We started this at 1:30, and for the last hour and a half, I've been eating crackers.
We heard that the audience was also, we just were told that the audience, you guys in the chat, are also very much on this cat as the mysterious man kick.
We still haven't seen
Mutton Chat.
We haven't seen the hairless cat.
The hairless fat cat.
Mutton Chat is not a social cat.
Yeah, but he's always been so weird.
He is weird. Like, you know he's weird.
Yeah, just a chubby gnome with straw-looking hair and a fat, hairless cat.
I mean, if you can't see his face, if you can't see the guy's face, I mean, I bet that cat could put on a trench coat. And
perhaps a polymorph ability?
It could be a polymorph, yeah.
You're living a sad life, Eugene.
Well, I don't know about that. I get out sometimes.
This is the most single man life I've ever seen.
Well, no.
Why don't you get Grindr?
I saw a few weeks ago, I saw that new play, Minions.
Oh my God.
How was it?
It was hilarious.
Did you identify?
We can all tell that cloak is pleather.
All of us can tell.
Well,
you make enough money to afford a real leather cloak.
Well, I'm saving for retirement.
That's why we're not together anymore. The style.
Oh, come on. Most people can't tell.
You didn't like his style, but you loved his hair?
I did not like his style. Loved his hair.
You bought a stallion.
All right, can we focus on what you're doing? You spent 2 hours wandering around my home.
We'll focus if you promise to get on Grindr.
What is Grindr?
Axe Grindr. It's where you fuck other you know, people who wield axes.
It's kind of like...
Yes.
I've never wielded an axe. I'm a dentist.
Well,
Why would I be on Axe Grindr?
Because it's a very easy way to find sexual...
That seems so specific of a way to find people to have sexual relations with.
What do you
mean? I mean, it's right up your alley. And then maybe you won't, you know, go around throwing around the word harpy. You know?
Ooh,
true. Slur in this world, I found out recently.
I'm sorry, I wrote that on that box in a night that, it was a couple nights after you left, I wasn't pleased.
Yes, tell me about how you weren't pleased. Your eyes.
What? This is none of your business. I hired you for a very specific task.
I just want to know when you bought that stallion.
Give us your gnome phone.
I bought that stallion a little after my 41st birthday.
And what type of vehicle did you have before that?
I didn't really have a vehicle. I walked to work.
You walked to work?
It took him so long.
It's not that far.
It took us an hour to get here from town.
Well, you don't know where the dentist office I work at
is. Is it closer or farther than town?
I mean, we're still in town. Okay. So technically, it's in town.
You also have a little gnome scooter.
I rode that once.
How humiliating.
Rice.
Just tell us about it. There's a motorized scooter.
What did you find, Squeak?
Ah, yes, friends. A brotherhood of the skull, as I shall call the three of us now, for we are wearing the bandanas. Mm-hmm. I found a window upstairs that's busted.
Oh!
Any word on this?
Yes.
Oh, that's just... There was a break-in about... 2 months ago.
You didn't think that was necessary to mention?
It was 2 months ago. The city guard already came and took a report and are looking for the perpetrator. They said that most of the time in situations like this, they never catch them.
Yeah. Were you home or not?
I was coming home from, that was actually the night I saw Minions.
You were coming home from Minions?
Yes, and I came home, the door was ajar, and I came in.
What time?
It was around... I came home, I think, around 11?
No.
After
10 o'clock.
Yes.
I guess. Mm. It was 2 months ago. This man has just started appearing within the last week.
Let's not call him a man. He could be a cat turned into a man.
Mm-hmm. Wearing a trench coat.
Yes.
Is this a bad area? Or since the pop-up shops came, it's been getting better.
this is a little far away from Market District for the pop-up shops to have any. Also, this is like a nicer area of town, so like, definitely already gentrified.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Mm. This break-in still happened. Mm-hmm. And you didn't fix this window? You're a dentist. You bought a stallion.
I just haven't been around to it. It's a second floor window.
Let's do this. Google. You have somebody looking at you outside. It doesn't matter what before the window.
I went off the window. First thing.
Someone's supposed to be coming next week. They were backed up. Get off my back.
You know, you're taking this too lightly. You always take break-ins and... stuff like that too lightly.
I reported it, so I don't know what else you
want
me to do.
Can I say what I found?
Sure.
I found a big giant dent next to the piano when I lived in the house. That was a pristine, clean area. So something happened there.
The dent on the piano? Yeah, that showed up sometime.
Do you realize how unaware you sound? Like, if a dent showed up in my nest, I'd be like, something's weird. Something's up.
No, it showed up. I don't know if it was the same night as the break-in, but I noticed it sometime after that.
If there was a dent in my candy house, it would fall down.
Oh, you have a candy house?
Yeah.
Very cool.
My name's Sugar Socks.
I told you not to spend money on that candy house.
You have a piano, hey. And a stallion, and a hot pool.
Those are tangible assets.
If there was a dent in the piano that I have at home, which I consider to be a grand piano, which you guys may call one of those things where you blow on it and play.
A melodica?
A melodica.
Yes.
Okay. Then I would know about it.
Look, I didn't that is think how I make magic. The dent in my... Okay, I didn't think the dent in my piano had any pertinence for this very specific thing I asked you to do.
It's in your home. Who else has come by? Who could else? Have done that?
Were you knocking back a few and danced into it?
Ooh. I mean, there have been some nights since you left where I maybe had a bit more to drink than I would normally, but... Oh.
You also got to get rid of that pillow that she made. You're really clinging on to the past, man.
I love this heterosexual marriage.
Fine. Why don't I just put the pillow in the harpy box?
Ooh, shots!
We don't need to help you, but we do love money.
We love money.
You ever heard my song?
You need to help
money,
me.
Money, money, gold, money.
Ooh, that was from your fourth album, Copper,
money,
Copper.
Gold, money.
I'll keep that pillow and I'll sell it on Elpsy. Elpsy?
Start off with
it's
10
like Etsy
gold.
For Elps.
Now I got 6 gold.
That's very specific.
What does R&B stand for again?
Rhythm and bar.
Yes. It never gets old. Truly.
Yep. Sip. All right. So, you guys have investigated. It's now, after all this discussion, it's like 3:30. What do you want to do? You want to, like, go check anything else out? Do you want to...
Maybe we scour the outside. Just see if there's any...
Anything unusual.
Yes, see if we can prepare for tonight.
We still haven't seen the cat.
That's true.
Mutton Chop?
Yes.
He's probably hiding in the closet.
I want a
Which
chance.
Which one?
We looked.
You looked through my closet?
Yes,
oh,
we
yeah,
looked.
Oh, yeah, we thorough.
I mean, I thought we did. Should we try again?
I didn't. I found those Ace of Chips.
Audience wants to know if your albums have gone triple wood. Hey, yeah. Tardis X?
My albums have gone triple wood. Multiple
right.
times.
Multiple
albums
times.
Albums 2 and 4 went triple wood.
Ooh.
Album 1 went 10 gold.
10 gold?
Mm-hmm. That's why I wrote the song on the second album. You start off with 10 gold, and now you have 6 gold.
Oh, because the second album didn't... No, wait. Wait, the second album, then what? So if the first album was 10 gold, what was that supposed to be, like, a song about, like, the disappointment of dropping somehow?
Mm-hmm.
It's deep.
But you still got gold.
All right.
I love it.
That's also, just so you know, that's not Scorch talking. That's just me, the DM, being interested okay. in your musical career. Great. So you guys want to look around outside? Is that what you said?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I want to search around the light pole that he's to see if there's any clues around the light pole.
Great.
Because I am very stealthy, and all I need, I have this mink coat on, so I can just kind of roll over, and people just think I'm just a
great
an animal.
So you're looking around
the light pole.
Where are you looking?
I want to take to the skies, as I am a bird person,
uh-huh.
and just kind of like look. Kind of get an aerial view of the land and see, like, maybe if there's any way that somebody could have, like,
okay.
crept up the wall or the, whatever, the brownstone
uh-huh.
wall into the window.
What do you do, Kate?
I'm going to check out the interior of the hot tub.
So you're going to investigate it?
I'm going to investigate the hot tub.
Okay, great. So let's do the lamppost first.
Mm-hmm.
So you're looking around there. So roll an investigate check.
Ooh.
Ooh. 16 on here. Ooh. Plus 3 plus 2 in intelligence, so 18.
Great. So I'm gonna tell you this. You rolled so well, and you're also trained in Arcana.
Yeah, what does that mean?
That's like magic stuff.
Okay.
So because you rolled that well and you're trained in Arcana, you know, so you investigate, and you're looking around the lamppost. This part of town, it's got clean cobblestone streets, it's, you know, upkept, and there's these tall, silvered lampposts every 25 feet or so
mm-hmm.
For light at night. And this post is almost directly in front of the house's front window, and while you're investigating, you kind of notice there seems to be some sort of bluish residue coating the stones in front of the post. But because you trained in Arcana and you rolled so high, you also can tell, you know, you've seen this before, that is dried ectoplasm.
So this dude's an alien?
Or a ghost.
What? I'm flying. I can't hear you.
Yeah.
But yeah, that's like ectoplasm is something that, you know, like ghosts, poltergeists, that type of stuff, like tends to leave behind.
Like Slimer.
Yeah, like Slimer.
Okay.
Slimer.
So there's a blue dried ectoplasm in kind of a not a puddle, but I guess a circle, a dried circle in front of the lamppost.
Okay.
So that's what you find. Well, you're flying around, roll a... Do a perception, because you're high up. It's hard to investigate from high up.
12 plus 15, and I am trained in it.
Great. 15 total?
Yeah, 15 total.
So you can see all these houses have fairly nice backyards, although they don't all have pool-sized hot tubs. it seems like that backyard, there's almost no lawn left because it's taken up by such a large hot tub. Other than that, it looks like a pretty normal neighborhood. There's like at one end, kind of where you start getting more towards the center of town, there's like a city guard post, but that's pretty typical. There are some other houses with nice yards. There's one like little old lady who probably just isn't at work because she's retired, across the street in her yard.
I want to talk to her.
Working on like a flower bed. And that's all you really note.
Do I see anything like, I was trying to look at like the window and if anybody like maybe had like fly near the
window
house
that
itself.
You found, bro.
Yeah, just on the second floor, see if anybody had like climbed up or how there was any sort of entry from the outside.
You can't really tell any more than, you saw the broken latch, but
okay.
There's not like markings, like claw, like I assume you're looking for like if something made marks while climbing
yeah.
up there or broke anything. You don't see anything like that.
Or footsteps. Maybe they had some wrong trousers on
no,
or something.
No, there's no wall footsteps.
Okay.
Sometimes you wear the wrong trousers.
That is true.
Yeah.
So Katie, then you were investigating the pool. I guess roll an investigate check.
Okay.
Or the hot tub
for the
pool.
20.
Yeah.
16.
You can tell that is a very large hot tub and that it is pretty warm. It's like kept, it's probably magically kept at like a comfortable temperature.
It's not too hot.
It's not too hot.
I'm finding out a lot of good stuff.
Mm-hmm. I mean, you wouldn't keep your hot tub on uncovered when it's that big all day. It would take a ridiculous amount of energy to keep it hot.
So, but through magic.
Yes.
It is.
Yeah. It's like, you probably like, there's like a dial in one part that probably adjusts it to like, it's magically powered, but you still have to adjust it to get it like warmed up to
mm-hmm.
the correct temperature. But it's like still lukewarm right now.
Mm-hmm. Can I say what I see in the hot tub pool or no?
You don't see anything.
Oh, okay, never mind. I don't see anything.
It just looks empty. So what do you guys want to do now? You want to regroup?
Yeah, I want to swoop down to Tartus X.
Okay.
What did you find? I saw a little old lady.
I just found this blue ectoplasm around the light post.
I feel relaxed.
Oh, hey. Were you looking for things or are you just chilling in the pool?
I was looking for some stuff.
What'd you find?
Nope, nothing.
Okay.
Feel really ready to go.
So what now, guys?
Well,
I need to figure out a way to investigate this ectoplasm.
Yeah, let's make sure it's not dinosaur blood.
Yeah, and make sure it's not from that damn cat.
Ooh, that damn cat.
That cat's in a trench coat, and it's causing trouble.
So you know from that role, you knew that like ectoplasm generally tends to come from like ghost specters, some kind of like ethereal thing. Mm-hmm. But that's all you can really tell from that.
A ghost dinosaur.
A dinosaur?
Yes. Sometimes I pronounce it like that, and sometimes I forget
yeah.
to.
I'll investigate.
Yeah, I do too.
Eugene more.
Eugene?
I feel like he's hiding some stuff from us.
So, are you? What are you looking for specifically?
Why doesn't he download Grindr?
Downloading doesn't really exist in this world, but.
Why doesn't he magic?
Axe Grindr is a magical.
Oh, okay.
What did I ask Eugene for?
I'll tell you this. You can also, like, if you're looking for something that you wouldn't want to, like, ask him about, you could, like, you know, tell if, like, can you tell anything about him, too, if you're looking for something like that. But you can ask him stuff, too.
Yeah, okay, I want to ask him, has there been any supernatural stuff happening around his house?
Okay.
Yeah.
Good question.
Mm-hmm. So he kind of thinks for a moment and he says, no, I mean, I don't know much about the arcane, but I haven't noticed anything supernatural. That ghost had a symbol on its mask.
Wait, you knew it was a ghost?
Or that...
What?
Wait a minute.
Eugene. That was a clay slip. Because you guys have been calling him a ghost. I accidentally called him that. The man I saw in the long coat and the mask had a symbol on his mask.
Can you describe the symbol?
Yes.
Well, the symbol... I'll draw... I'm no artist, but I'll draw like a simple description of it. It was kind of like a crescent moon with a line down the center. He draws you guys.
Ooh, you are no artist.
Well, okay, I'm just trying to do something quick.
He's a member of the United Methodist Church.
Oh.
He's a Methodist, that's all that.
He's just a Methodist.
He's a Methodist?
Yeah. I don't know what that is.
Or maybe a moon buster. It looks like a moon with a thing through it.
He likes to hurt moons.
He's a half communist.
I don't know what it means, if it's magical or not, but that's something that the man had on his mask. It seemed like an odd place for a symbol.
What color was the mask?
The mask, in the light of the street lamp, it was hard to tell. I thought it was...
I'll be able to see it.
Dark brown with like a white painted on symbol, but it was hard to tell.
See, without me, you're just having a hard time because I can see things when it's dark out.
Yes, that's why I need you to see things when it's dark.
All right, you two, keep going.
I don't know if where you could find out where a symbol like that came from, but I mean you could go to a library or Council of Mages Guild.
I'd like to roll a history check.
History check?
On that symbol.
Sure.
Can I roll the heat down? I'm wearing a mink coat. It's getting a little warm in here.
Ah, yes. 7.
No, you are have never... You've not only never seen that symbol before... You've never seen any symbol with a crescent moon before.
I don't know what this thing is. What is this thing? What is this curious shape?
It's the moon children. The people, the moon children, wear that symbol.
The moon children.
That is true. There is a group called the moon children.
Is there actually?
No.
Okay.
But we'll say that you've heard of like a group that you used to be friends with called
the moon children. Yeah, I used to hang out with a bunch of moon children.
But it didn't have a cross through it. Doesn't necessarily be related. It's
so
just
maybe
something.
He's a moon child gone bad.
Mm.
I would like to do a library check.
We'll call that a history check.
History check and check the microfiche. And see if we can find something in this neighborhood.
Go ahead and roll.
That's old school for now, but new school for Forgotten Realms.
10.
You don't really recognize it either.
Ugh.
Sorry.
Can I do a check?
Sure.
It's a 20. Okay. 17.
What's your intelligence?
Plus.
Oh.
Minus one.
16. So you haven't seen this symbol, but maybe it's because of those friends you had who were like not the best characters. It does the way he's not just the symbol, but the way he's describing it painted. You have heard vaguely about certain, like, burglars or street gangs or stuff like that, that because they, you know, want branding or whatever, they'll, like, their masks that they wear, they'll paint a symbol. You haven't heard of this one specifically, but you heard that that is done sometimes in gangs of criminals.
Yeah, they're, like, a cool gang.
Can we go see one of these gangs? One of the gang leaders?
It would take a little while because they're not, like, this is a nicer part of town. But that's good info to do. You could do it if you wanted to. You would have to take some time to track
what
one.
What time is it? It's only 4 o'clock, right?
It's about 4.
We have a while. We have to wait till 10 p.m.
Yeah. Let's have some tea with the gang.
Yes. You'll keep me from taking a nap.
And, like, you don't have to, you could find the gang, you could find someone else, you could...
Now, I'm an outlander, which gives me the wanderer ability, which means I have an excellent memory of the maps and geography of a place.
Okay.
So, I, you know, do I know where perhaps the gang would be located?
Have you looked at any maps of gangs recently?
Yes.
Have you?
Yes.
Have you?
I have.
He loves maps.
Have you?
Where, okay. I'm not lying.
Tell me where you saw a map of the gangs of this city.
Look, I hang around seedy areas. Pun, bird pun intended. And,
all right,
yeah, we'll say, that was worth it.
We'll say, roll another history check to see if you...
Ah, yes, history, my least, my worst skill. 10.
10? You don't know. However, you do know that probably, like, city guards or, like, you know, the equivalent of police in this area probably have their own maps of, like, where the gangs are located and stuff like that.
Triple Skulls, we must, perhaps we should shake down a city guard.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Great.
Cool.
Quick agreement with everybody. Okay, so you're going to look for a city guard or, yeah?
Sure. Can I scope one out from up top?
Well, when you were up top, I mentioned you saw like a city guard post at the end of the street, because those tend to be periodically throughout the cities, there's like a little, like a police box
cool
type thing.
There's one at the end of the street. Maybe we'll pass by that little old lady.
Yeah, she's directly across the street from Scorch Long Whistle's place.
I mean, she's the only person.
I want to talk to the old lady.
Okay. So she's in her front lawn working on some like flowers, bed type plants. Flowers.
Hey, what's your deal?
You just walk up to her and say, hey, what's your deal? All right, she kind of looks up and says, excuse me?
What's your deal? What are you doing?
What? I'm in my own yard. What are you I'm working on my flowers.
Do you want a trench coat?
Do I own a trench? No. All
right.
What? What is this about? Excuse me, young lady.
Have you seen anything suspicious in the neighborhood?
Suspicious? Well, oh my, the other night, I was looking outside and I heard a big racket. That Long Whistle's cats were all caterwauling and it was so loud it woke me up and I went to look at what was going on. I saw a man outside under his street lamp. Isn't that interesting? Now, Mr. Long Whistle was coming out and the man just disappeared. Poof. Like he was never there. It was very, very disconcerting.
Coat and all?
Yes.
The whole thing?
Yes. It seems like maybe the doctor may be consorting with some sort of wizards, mark my words. That Council of Mages, you know, I don't trust them. I don't vote for them. You know, I don't know why. And they never do anything. And she's like starting to get on like a local homeowners type of talk. Like, and you know what's really bad? Because like now she's an old lady and now she has an audience. You know what's terrible? They always say they're going to fix the potholes on the
old
street
woman,
and they never do.
You
Stop
will
it.
Die
I
soon.
I'm going to use my vicious
mouth.
You want to attack her?
Nobody
yes.
can ask you one damn question, you old bag.
Sacred flame.
Okay.
Yes, rise.
You dummy.
All right, so you're going to roll d20s. On this poor old lady.
Are we rolling for
initiative? I'm gonna kill the old lady.
No.
Go.
Don't worry about initiative.
Go.
Aw, damn it.
4.
Okay.
I'm an 8.
So, 4. Sacred Flame and Vicious Mockery.
Yeah.
Rolled a 4. Oh, I'm sorry. Actually, for Vicious Mockery, she rolls. I'm sorry, I screwed that up.
Oh.
Well, I screwed up on both of them, but we're just going to use your rolls as hers, so she fails them both.
So we just ream her with them?
So roll a d4 for the Vicious Mockery, and a d8 for the Sacred Flames.
Yeah, that's right.
So roll the 8-sided die, and
Wait,
the 4 is
that?
The triangle. Yeah.
Is that in this?
It was a rib. So roll that again.
What are you looking for?
Eight
whatever seven. Number that. So 3.
8-7.
Oh, okay. That's oh, okay.
Yeah. So 3. Oh, no.
4.
Okay. Well, between your insulting her and your lighting fire down on her, she starts screaming and is basically a flaming body and starts hobbling inside.
Rise!
And like collapses before she even gets to her. So
as she leaves, I just scream and intimidate her. I try to intimidate her.
Oh,
and...
I mean, I'll just say you can't intimidate someone who's burning alive.
But I'm still trying. I'm holding up the Triceratops butt that I sliced off in my past.
I just don't like when people talk a lot.
So she's dead. You want to do anything with the body?
Yes, let us keep a trophy.
Keep a trophy, but we can also set a trap.
Let's leave it in the trapdoor in the garden.
Body as a trap.
Okay. What was that?
We can leave her in the trapdoor in the garden.
Okay.
Covering up a murder.
What if we tied her up to the lamppost right before 10 o'clock?
Oh, that's smart.
And then the dude comes in and sees somebody else there in his lamppost. Now, we're all hiding out at this point, and he's flying over. So he sees the dude walking up, and he sees the body, and he's like, So that might make him come closer to the house.
Maybe we weekend at Bernathor's it, and you puppeteer the body of the old lady.
Weekend at Bernathor's is a great play.
Great play, almost as good as Minion.
Anything that's bigger than me, I can hide. Completely.
Yeah, that is true.
Yeah, I think we should put her in a trench coat.
I'm gonna jump in her butt.
Oh, you have. You could hide other places. You could.
So, all right. So you guys can absolutely do that if you want it. You'll have to drag her singed body. Probably like there's like a guard.
I'm gonna carry.
Guard post down at the end of the street. There's no patrols right now, but like you're probably gonna need to hide it until it gets dark. If you want.
Oh, I got that.
You can put it back in her house. She locked her door.
That's right.
So you want to drag it across to the backyard and put it in the trap door?
Yeah.
Okay, that's what you said, right?
Yeah.
Okay. I can carry her up high if we want to like avoid anybody who's like looking on ground level.
Great. I don't really care. Oh yeah, no, that's probably smart.
Okay, so you take the singed old lady's body.
Yeah, grab her with my talon.
50 or so feet up and take it to the backyard.
Ooh.
I'm just gonna pause, and if anybody's joined us, give you a recap on what's happened so far, because if you're hearing us talk about this, you might be confused. So far, they've been hired to find out why a mysterious man is looking in the window at 10 p.m. each night of Chipper Sugar Shoes' ex-husband's house.
Sugar Socks.
Sugar Socks, sorry.
Get under it, the shoes.
Who is named Dr. Scorch Longfellow, DDM, a dentist, and freaking out his cats, looking in every night at 10 p.m. So far, in helping him complete this job, they have broken into his house, scared him, threatened him, then gone outside, found out that there's ectoplasm, which indicates it's probably a specter or a ghost or something. That's the man standing outside. And then killed a woman in cold blood.
She was old.
And she was talking a lot.
She was talking a lot.
She was talking way too much.
She was rambling.
She wasted like a whole hour of our time. It's like 5 o'clock now.
It was like 4:30.
Felt like an hour to me.
A good chunk of the wasted time is you guys killing her and hiding her body. So her body's in the trap door.
I don't think we meant to kill her. You just meant to make fun of her and set her on fire.
Yes. I wanted to teach her a lesson, and then I was like, she can't handle that.
So what are you guys doing now? It's now like, after hiding the body and everything, it's like 5. It's starting to get, it's like getting close to dusk.
I mean, maybe we talk to that guard still.
Yeah, we go talk to
them. They won't suspect us for murdering someone if we just go talk to them, too.
Cool. Good strategy.
Should we hide the body?
Kill someone and then immediately talk to the police.
Are we covered in, like, blood or anything?
Should we hide the body before we do this?
I thought you guys already did.
Oh, we did? Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
You're not covered in blood because you singed her.
Oh,
you burned her alive, so the damage was more flames than lacerations.
That's
so.
How
I'm
a
little bit in my mink coat. I'm not happy about it.
It's just very light. Yeah. Most people couldn't tell that it was burnt.
You two are totally cooler than I thought you would be.
I'm unassuming.
Yes, I mean, good evil stuff.
With a name
stuff.
Like Chipper,
so there's a, you go, I'm sorry, you guys said you're going to the guard post?
If you guys want to.
Yeah,
sure.
Great. So you go up there, and there's like one guard kind of sitting on a stool. He's looking at a little book. But no, he's not like obviously lazy, but it's a slow time. It's a nice neighborhood. He's probably got, like, kind of a sweet position here.
Pretty bored, huh?
What? Oh, hello.
Hello.
Where are you from?
Can I help you?
What's that accent?
Huh?
Where are you from?
Oh, I'm from north above the Worm Ridge Mountain.
Oh.
Oh, cool.
Near Fenua.
Oh, it is near
What was he getting?
Fatty Wop.
Fatty Wop.
You should know that.
DM Clay forgot. He knows perfectly. Yeah. Oh, I love Fatty Wop. Oh, yeah.
Fatty Wop?
Fatty Wop's great.
Fatty Wop.
Fatty
it's great
Wop.
For camping.
Yeah. Ooh, it's a dangerous thing to say, I think.
Well, can I help you with something, Sittins?
Sittins?
You're the Sittins, you're sitting down,
God,
my friend.
I love
friend.
That accent.
Sittins.
Why did we come over here again?
To ask about the gangs.
Oh, hey, do you know anything about moon gangs?
We need a gang map of the city.
Yeah, you got a gang map?
Well, what gang are you looking for?
One
the
with
moon the... shadow.
Some weird shape.
Did you have like a picture of it or something?
Yeah.
Yes.
So you show him the picture that Scorch drew you?
Yes.
He looks at it and says, oh, yeah.
Half Methodist, half communist.
All thieves, probably.
I recognize this. There's a small time gang of burglars. I think they call themselves the Scarred Moons. But they're pretty inept. We catch them a lot, and the guys at the station all just refer to them as the Scare Goons. It's a little joke we have.
No!
Oh, that's so funny!
Oh, that's
good. Do you
good.
Have any here right now? Or do you have any at the station?
No, I don't think so. Although, I mean, I don't know the whole gamut of who we have in cells right now. But, yeah, you really don't have to worry about them too much. They're pretty inept. They've got this weird thing, and they always like to leave some kind of marking or... scar, they call it, on a home after they burgle it. It's real dumb because then we know exactly which homes they've broken into. I mean, they change it sometimes. It could be anything from like a gash on a wall to claw marks, and all kinds of different
stuff. A dent in a piano? What, where was the dent?
In the piano.
In the piano?
Sure, could be.
Mm. Ectoplasm?
They're not ghosts.
Okay.
An old lady's dead.
What?
Because she talks too much.
Have they ever killed an old woman?
Because they talk too much?
They're not usually killers.
Well.
No.
Well, I sure hope, yes, that wouldn't happen. But if it comes up, I bet they're behind it.
Well, yeah. I mean, I'll think about it, but it doesn't really fit their MO.
You seem pretty dim.
Huh?
Nothing.
So he hands you the paperback. That's about all the info he has for you cool. on these burglars. Is that it?
Yeah.
Cool. So you guys head back to the house. It's now like 6-ish. We're gonna take a quick break before you guys do anything else. And after this, it's probably getting pretty close to 10 p.m., so you might have to, you'll have more, a little more time, but you're gonna have about enough time left to like set up any trap you wanna do or anything like that. Okay?
Cool.
Cool.
Yeah.
So we will be right back, guys. And over this break, you guys are gonna be able to go to a link and submit jobs if you want. Do we have a vote up too, Will?
No, just the submission.
Just the submission? Great, so if you go to our Megaphone app at jash.com/play, you can also continue watching there, but there's a link there for you can submit jobs that you want people to go on in future weeks. We're gonna be doing this the last week of every month where it'll be a user-submitted adventure. We vote on them the week before, so submit stuff. And we'll make it into a real adventure. This was submitted by Bum Bum Party. There was a seed of an idea there. He kind of gave the details
Thank
and
you,
I filled
Bum
them all.
Party.
Thank you, Bum Bum Party.
Thank you, Bum Bum Party.
Bum? But yeah, submit some jobs and maybe you guys will, in February, get to have it played by a group of comedians like these. And they'll kill people in your campaign. So we'll be right back, guys. Thanks for watching. Hey guys, welcome back to The Aristocrats. We are still playing D&D on a user-submitted adventure from Bum Bum Party with Carl Tart, Justin Michael, and Katie Cunningham. As I've said before, I will say the word Bum Bum Party as many times as possible today.
Yeah.
Bum Bum Party.
Bum Bum Party!
If you guys are watching on our Twitch channel and want to vote on stuff that's going on, which we do occasionally in this show. You can also watch and play along at jash.com/play. Just to give you guys, well, I'll do a recap of what we're doing or what we've done so far with the quest in a sec. First, real people question again. So we already know like what your experience with D&D is. We like to ask sometimes too, like what's, if you guys have ever worked temp jobs, what's the worst temp job or like service industry type job you have ever had?
So many.
I work for manpower.
What's manpower?
Which is like, it's manual labor.
Oh.
And it, you just get called up. It's temp work, but for people who don't have. I worked there when I was like 18 and 19 years old. So I had just left college and I needed money.
And what's the worst manpower job you had?
I had to set up for a marathon one time. It's just like a lot of moving, like those locked fences and stuff like that. Like just a lot of. But I think what made it worse was that I was working with a lot of dudes who really like. They were nice guys, but a lot of drug addicts, a lot of dudes who kind of squandered their futures and stuff like that. And I had just left college at the time, and
kind of a nice welcome to the world of working.
And there was like one dude. I talked to, and he was like, "Oh, where you from out here?" And I told him like what area I was from. I was like. And he was like, "Oh yeah, I used to live over there too." And I told him what high school I went to. He was like, "I went there too. I graduated in '94, and that's like 23 years before I graduated." Uh-huh. And I'm like, "And you doing this?" And then we started coming. He was like, "Man, Mr. Patterson's still there? Oh man, that guy. He was my favorite teacher." And I'm like, "I got to do something. I got
to do something in my life." Yeah. Oh man. I feel like that's like a universal, like any sort of temp work, whether it's an office or manual labor or whatever, like there's that element of like, oh man, there's gonna be that moment of like, oh, that was rough though.
Yeah.
Justin?
I worked at a recycled tape factory at one point.
Wait, what kind of tape?
Like different types of tape. So that's like, amazing. You know, like big, like VHSs or like smaller, like, anything that had, like, there were even cassettes, too.
But not, like, scotch tape or duct tape.
No, I wish. That's way more, like, that's a funnier version of it.
I was really hoping you would say all kinds of tape. Any kind of tape you want.
Any kind of tape you can imagine. Nope.
But it was, like videotape.
Yeah, so it would be, like, recycled and wiped. But first, basically it was, like, quality control. So, like, you'd have to, like, pull out all of the tape and make sure that it was, like, I feel like you would break some of the tapes in the process. And then you'd have to wind it back up to make sure that it, like, was good. And it was just like an assembly line kind of.
When you said quality control, I thought you were going to say it, that you had to just like blank like a 6-hour VHS and then watch it for 6 hours to make sure it was blank.
Yeah, this is blank. What a great 6 hours.
Wow. Katie?
I've had so many weird jobs. It's not as good as that, though. In New York, I was like one of my first jobs ever, like I just wanted to do something that I thought was easy, so I was like the canvasser on the street for like Children's International.
Oh, no.
Where it's like, "Hi, would you like to sign up for this?" And you just get so much rejection in a day. And then I started in January, and in New York there's snow. So I was just wearing like a giant winter coat, like 18. It's like my first job, just like asking people to sign this in like a blizzard.
Oh,
it was
God.
So bad.
I haven't worked one of those jobs, but I've had friends who have worked as canvassers, and like, yeah, they've told me that like that's like one of the hardest jobs because
you don't make any money if you don't get
oh, you
like
that too.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah, you don't make any money if someone doesn't sign up, so you're just like, oh well. I mean, like you make like minimum wage, but it's not worth it.
That. Almost makes me feel bad enough to stop and talk to them.
There was another one.
Talk to them, guys.
That was another experience I had with like a dude that made me go, man, I got to do something with my life. I was canvassing for this thing called Environment California. Where I'm sure you talk to these people. They come up to you and they go, hey, do you have time to talk about the environment?
Yeah, uh-huh. Yeah.
And we had loaded struggling. Up in this van. We loaded up in this van. They took us to like this was in like downtown LA. They took us to like Pasadena, like Sierra Madre, to walk around the neighborhood and talk, like in this van. And me and my friends are 16 years old. There's an ad in the newspaper that says, make $1,500 a week. And we were like, that's so many Jordans.
Yeah, that's what they wrote you in.
We went to a Baja Fresh, and there was this dude who wasn't eating. Like, he was just kind of talking to everybody, and I was eating and stuff like that. And then I was like, almost done my food. Like, I had finished most of, like, picking at it and stuff. And he was like, are you going to finish that? I thought he was joking, and he was like, "No, I'll take it." And I'd already like put the napkin on and everything. I was like, this might not be the best job. This dude came
before to eat. Had he been working there for a while? No, like, this is great.
We worked one day.
Oh, okay.
I worked one day. Yeah. We quit, but also got fired. Like,
yeah, the girl who was like the top seller for Children's International was just like so jaded. She was like, I don't know anything about this stuff. It's all about manipulation.
Well, that's what you want, like a charity organization.
She was like chain smoking, and then she was like just drinking coffee all day and just like, and it's like middle of winter, like her nose is red and she's like, yeah, I just got it. She just seemed like strung out.
Did I mention I hate children? I killed four and just this week alone.
Well, on that happy note, we gotta, I gotta come up with a bit better like version of this question because I feel like it's always a downer. Yeah. But you know what? It's not a downer because you guys aren't doing that now.
No,
maybe like worst childhood moment?
Yeah, yeah, worst. Biggest fear that has come to pass.
Oh, I have a good one.
All right.
Let's move on.
Back into it. So you guys just talked to the guard. He told you about the Scarred Moon gang. And you're heading back to the house. It's like dusk. It's like getting around 6. So if you want to set a trap, you probably have to start working on it now before the guy comes. It's getting a little dark.
We had a pretty good idea. We were going to weekend at Bernathal's. That old lady killed. Mm-hmm. So what? Tartus was going to puppeteer her from her butt, I believe.
Her butt. I was
going
to climb into her butt.
I thought you were going to tie her to the pole.
We are, but I'm still going to be in it.
You got to check out a move. It's got to be like effective.
Okay. Okay. All right. So you guys want to set that up?
I'm having second thoughts about that.
What could possibly go wrong? I don't understand what you think could go wrong.
I won't be able to chase the dude. So you're going to be flying over the top.
I'll keep an eye out.
I have dark vision, so I can help, you know, see in the dark.
That's good.
Are you invisible as well?
No. And I got a real loud hat on, a little elf hat, and a gown, a ball gown.
So, describe your plan to me. You guys want to, are we sticking with that, or detail it to me so I can tell you how long it's going to take, or if you have to.
I feel like I should just hide behind the body.
Behind the body.
So like maybe after dark we set, like after it seems like everybody's like gone to bed, we set up the body, we pull it out from the cellar or wherever it is.
Okay.
And tying it to
the
a
garden
pole.
Cellar, yeah.
The garden cellar, yeah. And then at least I'll keep watch and like dive down if there's any enemy.
Okay, so you're diving around. Where are you gonna be behind, what is, define behind to me?
Cause literally it's like on the pole, behind the body.
So like behind.
Are you in the
trench
coat?
Yeah.
Like,
what about in the dress or something?
Yeah, I'm in the dress.
Yeah, I feel like you should be in the
trench
coat.
What I mean is, you don't know where this person's coming from. So like, what direction is like if he was coming from this way, then this is behind. But if he's coming from this way, then this is behind.
Yeah.
What are you assuming is behind?
Well, we don't know. That's why I'm the lookout. I'm hiding in a bush.
Yeah. Maybe she gives me a signal.
Okay.
Like, all right, just go.
Yeah,
and I respond to that because that sounded like a bird. And I am an Aurakocra.
And I go, ooh.
He gets excited whenever I make that noise.
All right. Great. So it's around. So once it gets dark, you guys are tying the body up. Great.
This is what you predicted would happen today?
Not exactly what I had written in my adventure
notes. I'm impulsive.
That's fine.
Have we eaten dinner? Is Scorch preparing us any type of meal?
Yeah, what's...
He brought you out each a glass of milk and some more Asa crackers and cheese.
Ooh, those Asa crackers are good.
I love all that.
I crumble them up, throw them on the ground, and eat them like a bird again because I'm a bird.
What's he
I did it too because it just seemed fun.
It's great. It's the only way to eat Asa crackers.
If you ask him about what he has for dinner, he just kind of says something. He's like...
He mumbles.
He mumbles, like, he's kind of done dealing with you guys, but he kind of mentions, like, I'm not paying to feed you.
Chipper, was he a good cook?
No. He made a lot of bland rice.
And rice is pretty bland already.
This is specifically bland
he
rice.
He made the rice more bland.
I'm going to remove any flavoring I can from this.
He buys, like, store brand rice instead of, like,
yeah.
a
and
dollar
more. And he
soaks
it in water for way longer than you should.
All day.
And then adds some flour.
And then he puts it in a crock pot, but it's just nothing else is in it.
Great.
Well, I am glad it is not raw, for I would explode if I ate some of that rice.
So you probably don't know what he's having anyway.
All right.
So you tie. It's. Are you guys just kind of like waiting in your positions until it gets to be 10?
I'm in the bush.
I kind of want to look around. I just want to make sure, see if the cat's around, that other cat.
I mean, they're indoor cats, but...
Mutton Chop was in the closet, right? Well...
He was in the closet. If you want, you can look for him again.
We never saw him, though.
Yeah, I feel like that cat is sneaky in a bad way.
Have we already tied the body up?
Yes.
What time is it?
You tied it up, so it's like 9.
Oh, okay, so it's
almost showtime.
Yeah, well...
You got time. If one of you wants to go in and look for, I'm blanking on the cat's name.
Mutton Chop. The hairless fat cat.
Yes. For some reason, I had Ben Simon. Seaman was on a few weeks ago and had a wizard named Mumblecore. I keep getting those two names confused.
Oh, that's so good.
Mutton Chop. You can go in if you want, or you can just wait for the guy to show up.
Wait, what? Say it again.
You can look for the cat. You can wait for the guy to show up, or if you have anything else you want to do, let me know.
Maybe, like... one of us can look for the cat just in case he shows up early.
Okay.
You might have the best chances of doing that.
Yeah, I can look for the cat. Because I can.
So you want to run in? I'll run in, look for the cat. Can I use Arcana to like maybe trace his steps, see if I can see some of his steps?
You wouldn't be able to use Arcana because it's not specifically magical, but you could, if you wanted to try and track the cat in the house, you could use animal handling, which is a wisdom based thing.
Yeah.
So roll a d20.
20!
Ooh. Wow!
Oh, snap.
Well, despite the fact of how hard it would seem to trace a cat with no hair so it leaves nothing behind, you are somehow able, we'll say it's left some claw marks or like some claw sheddings. Like cats do when they scratch, that have lead you to the front hall closet. Do you want to look in?
Yes.
Okay. So you look in, and there is a fat, hairless cat that's just kind of like huddled back in the corner, like looking at you a little nervously.
Do I persuade him to come out?
That would have to be another animal handling check.
Oh, okay.
But you can cut. He's a cat. You could probably like try to reach in and pet him or grab him or something. Or you could look at him and just.
Well, he's a big cat. I'm a small dude.
He's big compared to you.
Yeah.
So what do you
ride him?
No, you couldn't quite ride him.
All right.
I mean, you could. Maybe you crush
you
him.
You might crush him.
We've already killed an old woman today.
I guess technically any of us could ride a cat. It would just end bad.
I want to ride the cat.
I say afterwards, we ride that cat.
What should I do now?
Just while we're celebrating.
I got the cat now. Do I check it for magic?
What do you want to do? What's your goal with this? Are you specifically like looking for something, or you just want to see?
I want to look for ectoplasm on the cat.
Ooh. Oh, okay. Let's do an investigate check for that.
Okay. D20?
Yeah.
18 plus 2, 20.
That cat is smooth as hell. There's no blue ectoplasm on it.
That was a point run to 18.
I'll tell you this, you're sure that there's no blue ectoplasm on the cat.
And no traces of it. So this is just a regular.
Yeah, as far as you can tell, from that investigate check, this is a completely normal, fat, hairless cat.
Okay. All right. Well, I looked at the cat, and the cat is in the bag.
What bag is it in? What bag?
Nobody's allowed to sip any water from that one. So it's like 9:30. Like, do you want to do anything else while you're inside, or you want to go back out to your position?
Well, do we know just if cats are naturally afraid of ghosts or something? Is there a way to check that, like a nature check?
I would say that's an arcana check to know if animals are afraid of them.
What would a 3, a roll of a 3 get me?
You think animals love ghosts.
Guys!
Can I do it too?
Sure.
I want to do it too.
What would a 6?
I want to do it too.
You also think that cats love ghosts.
14.
You have heard the pretty common knowledge that dogs and cats will tend to like shriek and cry and like generally make a racket if they detect a specter or a ghost. Yeah.
And the room gets really cold.
Yes, if they're in a room, it gets cold.
Cool.
I'll tell you this, what else you know about ghosts? They usually haunt places where they died or like places that caused their death.
Mm-hmm.
So cats, they love ghosts, so it must not be a ghost.
Yeah. I guess that ectoplasm was just unrelated.
We are in agreement then.
All right, what time is it?
It's getting close to 10.
All right, I will go take my post.
Okay. Places.
You're flying around.
On three. One, two, three, ball.
And I imagine that the squeak on the like three, like use that as jumping and flying up.
Yeah, I definitely launch into the air and like kind of twirl, and I think it looks great, and I don't think you guys
you hear the theme song from, what is it? Never Ending Story?
Never Ending Story.
So you're behind the
corpse. I really want us to do that, guys.
I'm behind the corpse.
Can I use my holy symbol of Soon for something?
Remind,
it's the goddess of love and
beauty. That's kind of like what, like is a focus for your powers, your spells. So like, when you cast a spell, you're using that.
Like your Patronus?
Oh, you mean that's where my powers come from?
Yeah, basically.
Oh, okay.
So it's like getting a few minutes before 10, and like as it's turning to 10 p.m., there's like a shimmering around that spot where there had been the ectoplasm.
So where, is that where TARDIS is?
It's very close to him. And it's not coming from any one direction. It's just as of from nowhere. There's like a blue shimmering. And all of a sudden, a figure appears that's exactly as Scorch described. Man in a long coat with a mask with the crescent moon with a strike through it symbol. And it kind of appears, and it's glowing bluish at first. And then it sort of solidifies. And this... because you guys have rolled pretty well on your knowledge of ghosts. Like, ghosts can trance, can go between the material plane and the ethereal plane, which is like ghost world and real world. And so when they're kind of in between that, that's when like the ectoplasm stuff, they can, if they're tied to a place strongly enough, they can like solidify enough to look real.
So we just see this appear.
Yes.
I hurl a javelin at him.
Great.
Just from the air.
No talk, immediately attack. Great. So roll your attack, your d20.
Cool. It is 16.
16. That, let me find the ghost. That will hit. Javelin's piercing, so roll your damage.
1d6 piercing, so 2. I guess plus strength modifier or anything?
Yes, it would be plus strength modifier.
Okay, cool.
Can I also use something? Plus.
So five.
5 total?
Yeah.
All right. So this javelin, as you throw it, it hits the ghost, but it doesn't stop completely. It's like once the tip hits it, it's like it slows down as it passes through.
Doesn't water hurt ghosts?
Not really.
That's a made up.
I think you made that up.
Can I use Arcana? Well, can I use performance to persuade him to stay and watch me while he comes down?
Can I use Burning Hands?
So hold on. So now that we're in a fight, it's gonna go a little like by turn just to keep things in order. So Justin threw that. So he'll go first. He does that. So now Carl, we're just gonna go down the line like this.
Okay.
Carl, so what do you wanna do? You're behind the corpse.
I'm trying to figure out if I wanna come out and do magic.
Real fast, roll a stealth check to see if the ghost notices you.
That's 20?
Yep. And you get to add your dexterity.
Does this count?
No, re-roll that.
Ooh. 18 plus
dexterity?
Dexterity, 321.
Ooh, yeah, the ghost doesn't notice you behind the corpse. Maybe it's, there's another dead thing there, so he doesn't notice a living thing behind it.
Is the ghost attracted to this dead old woman?
It doesn't seem... Well, you can't notice anything because your reaction was to immediately launch it.
I'm a barbarian!
To you two who are just watching the ghost, it seems like it's very focused on the house. And like you two can see it's staring at the house, and the cats are now both in the window watching it. And like you can't really hear it, but you can tell by looking, like their mouths are moving. Like,
where is Eugene now?
You don't see him through the window.
Cats are moving their mouths?
Like they're meowing.
Oh.
So our trap
screeching.
I was so suspicious of that.
What do you want to do? He just didn't notice you. You didn't do anything yet.
I want to get some info on him. Okay. I want to use magic to...
So do you want to talk to him or do you want to do something else?
What would be better?
I don't know.
Because if I try to talk to him and he disappears, that ruins the whole thing.
That's possible. He did just get a javelin thrown at him, and he's like, you see him, like he was staring at it, and once the javelin goes through him, he like looks up at Squeak. Like that did.
Also, now I can tie his legs up.
If you want to try tying up a ghost, sure.
Yeah, I'm a harpoon his legs.
So. I don't think you have a harpoon.
I mean, well, just like.
What do you have? You have like a rope. You could like try and sneak around him and tie up his legs.
What can I tell what I have? I have a rapier.
A rapier? Like a fencing sword?
Okay. Leather armor, a guitar, entertainer's pack, and I got 6 gold left.
In the entertainer's pack, there is a little bit of rope if you wanted to try that.
Yeah, I want to try the rope, and I want to try to bind his legs together to where he stays.
Okay. We're going to say that is a dexterity check to get sneak up to him and like be able to get the rope around him.
Okay.
Okay.
All right, here we go. 12 plus 3, 15.
Okay, so you do get around him and you can slip the rope around his legs.
Okay.
Are you just like letting it be loose or?
No, I want to tie it up.
Okay, so you tighten it. As you tighten it, similar to the javelin that went through, like as you tighten it, it like tightens normally, and then once it hits him, it slows down but keeps constricting and goes through him.
Oh, yeah.
So,
I knew that was going to happen.
So it's slowly going through the ghost?
Yeah, so it's like he's half intangible.
Okay.
All right. Now it's Chipper's turn.
Oh.
Chipper Sugar Socks.
Chipper, I think I want to either bless or just shoot flames. I haven't decided.
You can do either one.
I think I'll shoot flames.
Yeah.
From my hands, from my fingers.
So for that, your sacred... Oh, no, the burning...
Burning hands.
Burning hands, great. So you're jumping out, and you... Oh, he makes the saving throw, so... You go after him. Now... It's like a cone going out. He's still by him, too.
So he's...
Oh.
He's gonna have to make... If you do that, he's gonna have to make a saving throw, too.
My cone!
You can do that.
Okay, cool.
You want to?
Okay. Well, I don't know. I don't want to hurt my... I think
also, please note to everyone, the last line on this spell is, this ignites any flammable objects in the area. Oh, wait, that aren't being worn or carried, so your coat would be okay.
My coat would be okay?
Yeah.
Ah,
oh,
yes.
Okay, I'll do it.
You might not be here, but the coat would be.
I don't care.
Oh, no, I don't know.
I'm just saying, that's a very powerful spell for...
Maybe I should just do the guidance. Wait, so I give guidance to the target?
Guidance is an attack. That's to help someone else.
All right, I'm going to bless my allies.
Oh. Okay, great. So he's still flying, so it's probably close enough for you to get you two, but that's great. So
I don't want to be blessed anyway. I'm evil.
So you bless you two. So the next time either of you make an attack roll or saving throw before it ends, you can roll a d4 and add that number to whatever you roll it. So it just makes it easier to do stuff. So you guys have each gone. So now the ghost kind of looks up and he looks at the thing and he says, this does not concern you mortals.
Ooh. Hello.
And that's all he does this round. However, he does look at you and like his face, he's basically trying to scare you. and his face starts like melting a little bit. Mm-hmm. So you gotta make a...
Don't drip on my coat.
So you gotta make a...
Yuck.
Saving throw. So roll a d20 and add your wisdom.
I don't like melting faces.
Okay, so he scares you. So you're now frightened.
Okay.
So any rolls that you do against him until this ends is at a disadvantage. So that means you roll the d20 twice and take the lower number.
Okay, so again?
So not yet, but basically at the end of your next turn, you can roll to try and end this again. So you're basically scared of him and you can still do stuff, but it's like throwing you off.
Okay.
All right, so Justin, it's your turn now.
I swoop down and just like land right in front of him.
Okay.
And I try to like puff up my feathers. I try to intimidate him, intimidate the ghost, and scream in its face like, "Are you a dinosaur?"
Great. Roll an intimidate check.
To be clear, I am proficient in it, but still it is a negative number. 15. Oh.
15 total?
Yeah.
All right. He kind of stops and looks at you and says, God, gotta find my sheets and get them ordered. It's good enough to stop him from like attacking or like trying to scare you, but he looks at you and he says, "I am Vandermox, and I will have my revenge."
You didn't answer my question. Are you or are you not a dinosaur?
No.
Alrighty then.
Okay.
Just don't get no face on my coat.
That's a new coat he just got.
So it's your turn now?
All right. I'm gonna have to take the lower number.
Yeah, well, what are you trying to do? Sorry, before you roll. You'll roll to try to stop being frightened at the end.
I want to roll a persuasion.
So what are you trying to persuade? Like, what are
I
you
going to
say?
I want to get some info out of him. Why are you here?
So what are you going to say? What does TARDIS X say to the ghost?
I'm going to say, "Please, sir, why are you here?"
Okay.
So, I'm so frightened by you.
Oh, sire.
So go ahead and roll your d20. So you're going to roll it twice and take the lower number because you're scared of it.
All right. It's a 6.
Oof. So it's 6.
Minus.
We had a 6 and a 17, but you got to take the 6. He kind of looks at you and he doesn't give any more info, but he just points at the house. So it doesn't give any more info, but he just kind of reiterates
what
he said.
Can I create an illusion?
It's your turn now, so yeah, what do you want to do?
I want to create an illusion of a dinosaur.
With thaumaturgy?
Yeah.
Okay.
What is thaumaturgy?
Thaumaturgy is you create a simple illusion that can be a couple of things. Wait a second. Thaumaturgy, you can't actually make... there's another spell. You can't do that. Thaumaturgy is more for things like making a sound or make your voice louder or, like, make something glow or change in color. You can't really make, like, a full illusion with it.
Oh.
Sorry.
All right. Well, I can cause harmless tremors to throw the man off the ghost man.
You want to throw what off the what?
I want to throw him off, like...
Who?
The ghost man.
Oh, just, like, get him, like...
rattle up a
rattle bit. Him? Okay, you can try that. You can try that, yeah.
Should I roll?
So, you don't have to roll to make the tremors, but roll an intimidate check for that actually doing anything.
In the 20?
Yes.
Yeah, plus that.
Oh.
Yeah. The ghost, shockingly, a ghost doesn't give a shit about tremors in the ground.
There is a dinosaur here, I feel it.
All right.
Be aware.
So the fact that you guys aren't moving out of his way, he kind of stops and says, "I will show you what I will do to it, the beast." And he kind of like...
What beast?
Raises his hand, and from the ground, one, like, it's the exact same normal size of one, but a ghost cat comes up and kind of appears and, like, comes towards you since you're right in front
of him. Does it look like one of the cats that he is owned by? Amazing.
No. He said he wants to show what he's going to do
to
them. But the cat comes after you, and now it's the cat's turn, and the cat takes a ghostly swipe at you. So
this cat is vicious.
The cat gets a 20.
A natural 20?
Not a natural 20, but
it's still 20. Good.
So he hits you for 3 necrotic damage.
Oh! that damn cat.
So yeah, the cat kind of like doesn't make any sounds, and it's like, it's a ghost cat, so it's like kind of half floating, half walking, but it won't, and it comes up and slashes. You feel its claws like, it's not like a normal claw, it's like, it kind of like when the javelin through it half goes through you, but it still hurts.
Oh no.
But it doesn't leave a mark.
It leaves a mark, but it's not the same as like a laceration.
Okay.
If that makes sense.
Then it's not like a zombie where he's gonna turn into a cat.
So now
I should hope not.
Now it's your turn.
Alright, you cat. I don't like you. You hurt me. So I'm gonna attack the cat with my great axe. So I just want to chop its head off.
Okay.
Its ghost head off.
Sacred Roll flame. Your
D20.
Natural one.
Natural one! Your axe doesn't even hit the form of the cat. It like goes over its head, and you spin around once. Like the axe was too much for you,
like
and the
weight
of it like spins you around.
Is it possible that I chop off the head of the dead old woman in the process, like when it's finished?
No, you're not close
enough. Okay.
Oh, that'd be great though.
Okay.
It doesn't scratch my coat, does it?
No. You haven't gotten up from like trying to like sneak around his thing. So,
right.
You know what? I actually forgot at the end of your last turn, you were supposed to roll to see if you were not frightened anymore. So go ahead and roll a wisdom check, and it's still a disadvantage, so you gotta roll and take the lower.
Oh. Ooh.
Natural 20.
Damn.
Roll one more time. Natural 20. He just rolled 2 natural 20s.
Honestly,
that's insane. You are, not only are you not frightened, you get your nerve back, and you get up, and whatever you do this turn, like, you don't have to attack, but if you do, whatever you do, you get a bonus to it.
Okay. I want to use Mad Arcana and persuade this dude to I want to put ghost handcuffs on him.
So
wait,
good.
Just with an Arcana check? Like you're trying to like use Arcana? So,
because you can't put regular handcuffs on him.
Right.
Clearly, he can't be bound.
So here's what I'll say: you could do that. You could roll an Arcana check to think if you know a way to stop a ghost.
Okay. Yeah.
But you couldn't like make ghost handcuffs. Sorry.
Okay. I wanna roll an Arcana check. Think if there's a way I can stop this ghost. All right. God.
7.
Man,
well, you know what?
20s.
You know what? You do know a little bit because of the bonus from those 2 natural 20s.
Mm-hmm.
You know that you know that, like, so you had known earlier that ghosts usually haunt the places they died or have caused them to die.
Mm-hmm.
You also remember that you can usually find something in that place to disrupt a ghost, and either usually those objects either make it either banish it outright or make it easier to destroy.
Okay. The cat. He has an issue with cats.
He seems to.
So
he doesn't like cats.
He doesn't like cats.
I want to bring out the fat cat.
Bring out that fat cat.
You'll have to wait till your next turn, but like you got that info.
Yeah.
And now it's back to Katie.
I want to touch an object and emit bright light.
Wait, so which power are you using?
The light.
Just light?
Yeah.
Okay.
I can use it as much as I want. So.
Yes, you can.
Light up the night.
What, are you just trying to make light in general appear, or are you trying to make anything specific light up?
The cat.
Cat in the window? Great. Okay, you do that. You don't have to roll or anything.
Because he might get all fired up.
The cat starts glowing. What color of light are you generating?
Pink. periwinkle.
The cat starts glowing with periwinkle light. Okay, great. The ghost does look back over at the cat. So now it's his turn, and he kind of like looks at the corpse that you guys went up, said, "I will show you," and he walks into the corpse.
Oh no! I shouldn't have killed that lady.
Oh wait, so he's now the old lady?
He does it at first, and he like starts, the body starts twitching. Like now you can't see the ghost. Now it seems to possess the
sacred
body.
Sacred flame. Yeah. Can I burn her again?
on your turn. So she kind of like starts doing, and like shockingly for this old lady's body, she's able to like bust the ropes that are holding this charred walking corpse.
Is the javelin still through her?
No, the javelin went through.
Or went through the ghost.
Went through the ghost, and like once it went through, it clattered to the ground.
Okay.
So now there's an old lady corpse there. Justin, your turn.
So I swoop up into the air.
Okay.
Just so I'm kind of out of range of like any melee attack, and then I just hurl a hand axe down at the. I hated that cat. That ghost cat is still there, or is it gone?
The ghost cat's still there.
Although, what am I gonna do with the ghost cat? I want to chop off that old lady's head now.
Okay.
So I throw it, and I'm trying to like cleanly slice off her head.
Great.
And hurt the ghost.
Roll your d20.
God. Seven.
Seven?
Yeah.
Oh man, your axe. You did a throwing axe.
Yeah.
It completely misses her.
All
right.
All right. What can I do? So I know. I have the information that he doesn't like cats.
Mm-hmm.
So I want to go upstairs and get the cat and see if that elicits a reaction from him.
Cool. So it's going to take this turn, like all these rounds that are happening, like it's like the equivalent of like 5 seconds in this like fight that's happening. Mm-hmm. So like you could use this turn to like run inside and grab the cat, but you wouldn't be able to come back out with it until next turn. But that's still a totally valid thing to do.
Yeah, I'll do that.
So you don't have to roll or anything because he's paying attention to these two right now. So you can get up and go in for the
All right.
So that's what you do this
Yeah.
Turn. Okay, great. So next turn you'll be able to come back out.
Sweet.
Okay.
So
you have a cat now.
Is the old lady still near the tree?
The old lady? Yes.
Okay.
Or the lamppost.
Yeah, that's what it is.
Yeah. Carl's not there anymore.
So my crossbow bolts? Does that
That's like the arrows of a crossbow.
Oh. Because I was going to crossbow her to a tree.
You can try to crossbow her to that street lamp.
Okay.
Yeah.
I'll do that. And
so
just pin her there so she can.
So roll your d20.
Sure.
And for your crossbow.
Damn it.
What did you roll?
Five.
Five, and you actually have a +5 to hit with a crossbow.
Ooh.
So believe it or not, because it's in this decrepit, burnt old lady body, that does hit.
Yes!
So you crossbow her, roll a d8 for your damage.
Is that this one?
The diamond one.
This one.
Yeah. That one? Seven.
Okay, so your bolt goes clean through this body.
Yes!
And like, it's a powerful enough crossbow bolt that it like, it's not just like clean through it, it like takes a chunk out.
Nice.
And the body just falls. And as the body's falling, it's like if you imagine the body and the ghost inside of it, well, the body falls, it's like the ghost is still standing up. So the body's down, now the ghost is back out.
Oh, perfect.
Yes. Yeah. So the body's like
I killed it.
Incapacitated.
Nice.
So now it's the ghost's turn. So you're inside, you're flying still?
I'm flying.
The ghost starts walking towards you since you just fired a bolt at it.
Oh no.
And it kind of, as it's walking, says, "Why won't you let me have my revenge?" And then tries to like touch you with its like ghostly fingers.
Gross.
And it misses. It like reaches for you, but you like get out of the way.
Well, I have my
time.
Shield too.
Yeah, you get out of the way. I guess it's like it. You bring your shield up, and it's like, it's kind of wispy, so it's like it hits the shield and goes out. and then the ghost cat is actually floating up towards you.
Go away!
And it tries to scratch you again. And it hits.
That's crazy.
So one damage. One necrotic damage.
Ugh. I hate ghost cats.
Alright. Carl?
Okay, so I run back out with this actual cat. And I go and I take it to the ghost and I hold it up like, ah! What you gonna do now?
And the ghost kind of like rears back a bit. And it, so like during this fight, before the fight, it looked solid. But when it started fighting and like everything's been going through it, it kind of had that blue haze. Now that the cat's near it, it kind of like solidifies again.
Yeah.
And it cringes away.
Hmm.
Okay.
So now we can strike it with something, right?
Maybe. You gotta try.
All right, I want to hit him. I want to hit him.
So, so you run out, you show it the cat, and that's a free action to just hold up a cat. So now you're fighting, but if you want to attack it, you can. You can do whatever you want. However, whatever you're doing, you're holding a cat in one hand.
Yeah.
A screeching cat.
Rapier.
Okay, so, yeah, you can do that. You're going to take a little bit of a disadvantage. Not disadvantage, you're going to take a little bit of a penalty because you're holding a cat in one hand, but you can still totally attack.
Okay.
Basically, for your rapier, normally you would go with a +5. You'll do a +3 instead.
Okay.
So still worth it to try.
Yeah. All right. Here we go. What's the rapier again?
It's like a fencing sword.
An uncomfortable word 20! To say.
Natural 20. Natural 20 on an attack means, yeah, that's your third natural 20, I think. That's insane. Fourth.
Mm-hmm.
That's insane. And a natural 20 on attack means you automatically do max damage. So, describe how you, like, how you
I got this cat in one hand. I'm keeping my arm. I'm a small dude wearing a mink coat. I got this cat in
one hand. That top hat.
No, mink hat, dude. I got this cat in one hand. I take the rapier, and I just try to, like, slice through him early and cut down.
Right. So, like, so it goes through, and the way all that, those other weapons and everything like went through but slowed down a little bit, but it didn't seem like they were actually touching it. This one now, it looks like you're stabbing a real person. Like, it goes in and like you feel the heft of his body.
Yeah.
And he kind of like and stares at you.
Wow.
So yeah, nice. Katie?
I want to pat the target on the shoulder, offer some advice.
Which target?
The cat.
The cat. Okay, great. What?
I feel like the cat's been really stressed out. Maybe like we could avoid a lot of this if like I was just like chill out. All
right.
Out.
So this is guidance. So you pat the cat that TARDIS is holding, and what do you say to the cat?
Say chill, baby. It's all right.
Okay. So for the way this works, we'll say that the cat, the way this works is the cat, because it's a little different than how it's normally worked, but I'll let you do it. You do calm the cat. That means for his next turn, TARDIS doesn't have that penalty because he's fighting well with the cat. The cat's like, stop squirming.
Perfect.
Okay? Cool.
I helped.
Yeah.
Now it's the ghost's turn, and it's kind of sneering, so it like tries to touch TARDIS now.
Cat's out of control.
Fight these?
Not the ghost cat. Ghost cat's still up by,
just by floating
the,
near me.
Floating around the bird man. And he gets where's your case? No, he does not hit you.
Okay.
He's like off balance still from you hitting him. The ghost cat again keeps following you because you're both up in the air. It's the only one. You do notice that the ghost cat now, like Vander Marks, the ghost, he looks a little solider.
Mm-hmm.
Solider? More solidified.
Solider.
Solider.
Oh my god. This, just so everybody knows, this ghost cat has rolled a 19, a 17, and now another 19. So it hits you again.
Gah!
Well, it only does one damage this time.
Ugh.
All right, back to you, Justin.
Okay. What was I doing last? Just floating?
You're flying?
Ah, yes. You stupid ghost cat. My one advantage over you is that I should be able to fly and you shouldn't.
I mean, don't forget that You do have your rage as a barbarian, so if you want to rage out,
I am single furious.
Ghost cat.
Yes, I rage. I hate you almost as much as a dinosaur. So
you have advantage.
And it's floating next to me, so I'm going to use my great axe in the air.
All right, just to make sure, just as a quick recap, just to, before you make this roll, I want to catch people up. These guys are helping defend someone from a man who's been watching at his window. Turns out it's a ghost who for some reason, hates this guy's cats. Right now, a fight is going on with a bird man about to swing a battle axe at a ghost cat 50 feet up in the air.
Yep.
Cool.
Roll your die.
All right. Natural 20, because it's with advantage.
It is with advantage. Great.
And I'm going to chop its head off. Okay. Like, that's what I'm trying to go for.
You don't even have to roll damage. The ghost cat dissipates.
Ha! Ha ha! We did it.
We did it!
So your rage lasts like for a minute or so, right?
Yeah, is that a round?
No, it's about 10 rounds or so. So you're raging for a bit longer.
Can I shout something?
Sure, I'll let you do that for free.
I want to help with your revenge, ghost.
Okay.
Very humble.
I'm evil.
Carl?
Okay. Now, so I hit him, and where am I at now? What do I need to do to him now? Because I stabbed him, he felt it. I still got a cat in my hand, but it's not moving now.
Right, so you could attack him again if you want.
Okay,
thanks
should I use a...
me.
You could also use a spell, yeah. You can do whatever you want.
I want to get this guy, I want to use my charm person spell.
That's only works, it doesn't work on a ghost,
oh, okay.
Sorry.
Okay.
Use it on me.
shit.
Right in front of Scorch Long Whistle.
Scorch doesn't care, though.
Yeah, he will.
Yeah, he does have that pillow still.
Would,
yeah, he does.
Yeah.
He's holding on to
Thunder Wave work on him? Make him fall?
Yeah, Thunder Wave would absolutely work on him because he's like more solid right now.
Yeah. So I already stabbed him. He's feeling that. Cat ain't doing nothing. I sent a Thunder Wave.
The one thing is, it could kind of like that burning flame because you two are so close to him. It
okay,
could
her?
Hit her too.
Okay, well I don't want to do that.
Save me.
Shoot. What can I do to this guy now? Can I rapier him again?
Yeah.
Yeah. Let's just get a little couple more stabs in there.
Great.
Yeah.
Stabby.
Let me see what I got going on here. Ay ay ay. 17
oh,
plus.
Oh, that's gonna hit.
Plus 5? Oh, no.
It absolutely hits.
Yeah.
Yeah. So roll your damage. So you don't get max damage this time. So for your damage, it's gonna be roll d8.
This one?
Yep. And then add 3 to the roll.
5, 6, 7, 8.
8. Awesome. He is not looking great. He's like, he's still solid, but like, before he kind of could pass, when he was solid, he could pass as a human. Now it's almost if you imagine like, he's still solid, but his visage, his appearance is like morphing into more of like a gaunt skull. Well, goodbye!
That's him!
It's a ghost!
The ghost lives!
It's
that's
a
him!
No, his cheeks are getting more sunken, and like his eyes are like going further in his head, and like chunks of his skin seem, you can see the muscle more. So it's like he's deteriorating. Deteriorating.
Oh man.
Katie?
Sacred Flame.
Sacred Flame him? Cool.
This is the die.
So he saves against that. No, he actually rolls, Katie.
Oh.
So he has, basically you hit unless he does well.
Okay.
And he does not. You Sacred Flame him.
Yeah.
So roll your 1d8. Oh, and that's radiant damage. So. It's actually great. With radiant damage, he's gonna be hurt by it even more because he's.
Wait, no, that didn't count. 3.
Wait, which die is that?
Wait, was that wrong?
Oh yeah, do the diamond shape one.
Oh, nice. Sorry.
It's okay.
Sorry.
Okay. Eight.
Eight.
Ooh. Wow. All right. So. 8.
Fuck yeah.
Wow. Okay.
We've beaten the shit out of this dude. Do we need to get any info from him?
Yes, we've all beaten the shit out of this dude. All three of us have definitely done that. I haven't only spent my time on a cat in the air. That's for sure.
So the radiant flames descend on him, and he lets out a blood-curdling scream.
That's music to my ears.
Yeah, he lets out a scream, and he's not totally dead, but he looks terrible. And he kind of, it's his turn now, he kind of wails like, "No, the monster tripped me while I was on my last job. I have no rest until I kill it."
He sounds like he's from Brooklyn.
Ah, yes, Brooklyn.
"Please, I must destroy that cat to end my suffering."
Hold up.
So that's what he did. He is like gonna try and attack you again because he's begging, but he's also like, actually he doesn't attack. He tries to scare you again. Right. So it's the same thing. Make that saving throw.
This one?
Yeah. So roll with your wisdom.
12.
That is fine. So he doesn't scare you. 11. Understandably, he doesn't scare you because he's not in great shape.
Yeah.
So Justin, it's your turn now.
Okay. So I swoop down and I'm like, "Wait, you want us to kill another cat? But tell me more about your plight."
He points at the cat that he's holding. He says, "That cat tripped me. I fell down the stairs. I died from a concussion."
So you were trying to, let's say, rob this place? Yes. Yeah. Yes, and you want to kill the cat? You were killed by a cat?
Well,
we have a common enemy.
I tripped.
Yes, yes, I want to aid you. I will help you.
You want to aid him?
Yes, I am lawful evil. Okay. And I hated that other cat.
Why'd you hate the cat?
Because the ghost cat?
Okay, he made the ghost cat appear.
I know, but I hate cats and I'm lawful evil and I want to help a revenge scheme.
Okay. Why? We need you.
Why?
You travel so far.
This is your ex-husband. We can just loot his place. So, you could have that piano.
So I do want that piano.
So you took to talk to him and get that info, that took your turn.
Cool.
To do that. So now, Carl, it's your turn.
Okay.
You've got all that info.
I'm stopping him. I don't want him to. I don't want him to help this dude.
Yeah. Okay. No. Yeah. No.
I bought you scarves.
I bonded with this cat. So now.
You're friends with.
They were on
sale. I have to hit him with something, right?
It was 3-1.
Him? No, he's not doing anything yet. So you don't have to hit him. You could keep attacking the ghost.
Okay. One more rapier. 7 plus...
7 plus...
Plus what? Dexterity?
For your rapier, it's plus 3. So
plus 3,
10.
So 10.
It just barely misses. Okay. It goes right past him.
All right.
Katie?
Sacred Flame.
I mean, that worked real well last time.
It just makes sense.
So he's got to save against it again. Ooh, he actually, he must be getting desperate because, you try to, bring Sacred Flames and something about his, necrotic energy just, bounces them away. So he's like...
damn.
So now it's his turn again.
And you heard what I said.
Yes.
Okay.
So he tries to possess you because you want to help. So you have to succeed, roll a saving charisma throw.
Oh, that's not good. Oh, natural 20. 20.
Ha! So he comes towards you and tries to
see you again.
What are you doing? And somehow the guy with a -3 to charisma I guess you ruffle your feathers a bit. And he pulls back, so he's not able to possess you.
All right. I wanted to help you, but you just wanted to get in my body without asking.
Help me by letting me have your body.
Don't help this man.
Don't help him.
It's your turn now, Justin. What does Squeak do?
I am lawful evil. This seems like an evil plot. But he did try. This, he feels like an idiot, kind of.
I mean, the guards did say these thieves were not the most apt. Might even call them inept.
I will make things just. I will kill you, and I will also kill the cat. But you will not get to watch it.
And so, I go for his head. I try to chop his head off with the great axe. 16.
16? You hit. Roll damage.
Great. Ooh. Wait a minute.
Please.
So it's not a very good roll. 5.
5? So your axe does go through his neck, and like his ghost head comes off. Instead of falling, it kind of like raises up, but then from that separation, like light just starts streaming, and all of a sudden it gets very bright, and this ghost like starts like, he's not making a sound, but his mouth starts like opening like a scream and swelling with the light.
Is it like the end of Hocus Pocus?
I don't remember the end of Hocus Pocus well enough
sounds
to confirm
sounds exactly
that.
Like that.
This but sounds like the end of Hocus Pocus.
Basically, that gap between his head and body, light keeps pouring until it gets bigger and bigger, and then there's just an explosion of light, and when your eyes clear, the ghost is gone.
Classic Hocus Pocus.
And then the song plays that Midler sang.
Yeah, where's Bette Midler?
Where is she?
What's she up to in this world?
Bette Midler?
Yeah.
Guess we'll have to find out next
Bette
week.
Bette Midler's my mom.
Okay, she's my mom. So the ghost is gone.
Okay.
And the cat seems more calm now, even without the bonus from that. So, yeah, you guys can go in and talk to Scorch if you want.
I head towards the cat.
So what?
I go straight back into the hot tub pool.
You head towards the cat, what do you do?
I'm on Ace of Chips.
So Tartus,
yeah, those are inside.
Yeah,
so are you gonna let him? He's coming for the cat. You gonna do anything with the cat?
I don't give a shit about this.
So you just let the cat go.
Yeah.
All right.
Good riddance, cat.
So you go inside. You go to the pool. You're left alone with this cat.
Yeah. So I scoop the cat up with my talons.
Okay.
And I kind of like hold it close to, like, kind of curl my body up and just hold it close to my face, and I'm like, your body will die.
You seem really bad at this threatening.
I do have negative charisma.
Your body will die.
You're a bad dog. Cat, you're a cat.
As you're doing that, and as TARDIS is walking inside too, Scorch comes out and kind of says, like, I saw the light from inside. Is it over?
Oh, yes. Hello, dentist.
Eugene
Scorch.
Scorch.
Long whistle.
Dr. Long Whistle.
At that point, I grab the pillow that says, my pillow that I made.
Yeah, he's clutching it in front of his chest.
Yeah, and I say, yeah, it's over. And then I mug to a fake camera.
No one knows what's happening when you do that, but they kind of move a little past it.
Who's she talking to? Who's she looking at?
I just go.
And so he says, well, wonderful. I guess it seems like the contract is fulfilled then. So you guys completed the quest. You can do anything if you want now. Before you guys say anything else here, I'm just going to let the audience know. If you want to vote on how much loot, bonus or negative, they get, you can do
that.
Are we doing
that
one?
I did that already.
Oh, you did it already?
Yeah.
Are we also?
We can do the loot now.
All right. You guys can also vote on, there's one piece of loot at the end of each adventure, and you can vote which of these three get it.
Money, gold, money.
I killed a ghost cat.
So you guys can vote for that on jash.com/play right now. Keep watching that, the Twitch stream, or feed, the Twitch feed keeps going on that site. And, well, that's happening. You guys, do you need to do anything else?
Yes.
Are you doing anything with this cat?
So, you stupid haired dentist, tell me, give me one good reason why I shouldn't drop this cat from the air and watch
stupid
it splat.
Head.
Because I'll pay you much less!
What if you pay me more
it's
if I don't do it?
It's already on contract.
The contract specifically stipulated different types of payment based on.
You are such a wiener! You are such a wiener!
What?
Gosh!
You're
what?
Such a wiener! Give me that.
How bad do we need this job, man? Oh. My album didn't go triple wood.
Yeah, but your seventh album was like.
She's trying to say
pretty
all bad.
All of us are financially stable. We don't need this. We just love adventures.
He's not.
I am definitely not financially stable. I come from a nest with no money.
I have a mink coat and a mink hat.
Yes, I spent most of my money on scarves.
I feel like that might be like one of his next songs. I have a mink coat and a mink hat.
I like gold.
Your
money,
new hit
money,
single.
Go money, money, money.
Go money, money, money.
So, are you guys doing anything with the cat? Or are you
I hurl the cat into the pool, into the
and
hot pool.
I start playing with it.
Mutton chop!
He's wearing Tim's.
Yes. More like wet and chop. I'll chop off his head once he's wet.
I'm in the pool.
You didn't kill a cat. You didn't kill one of them.
No, I kind of let it off
so
easy.
So that doesn't hurt you too much. What was the bonus they voted on?
Plus two
gold. So Scorch Longwhistle kind of grumbles because you threw the cat, and he does take one gold off the top because you did that. You're very rude to his pet. So in total, you each get 16 gold from him.
Each?
Oh,
each.
Thank goodness. Because I spent so much.
TARDIS X.
Go,
sing one of his songs while you make it dance.
Go, money, money, go, money, money, go. Go, money, money, go. Okay.
Also, so everybody in the audience knows, this is a 3'6" halfling who's singing this and dancing with a mink coat on.
So badass.
Can we move on? Or do we still?
In the meantime, Carl also gets the loot.
Ooh.
Carl gets the loot.
Yeah.
TARDIS X gets the loot.
I get all three shares of 16.
No. You each get 16, and then Scorch comes up to you separately and says, "I really appreciate you treating my cat with respect.
Yeah.
If you want," and he kind of slips you a card that says "One free tooth cleaning by Scorch Longwhistle DDM," and in tiny text it says, "Come by ahead of time to schedule your appointment. No walk-ins."
Okay.
So you get a card for a free dental cleaning.
Nice.
Oh, that's cool.
That's great. That's very
that's
useful.
That's the loot you
get. Let me see here. So
again, kind of a wiener loot from Dr. Scorch Longfellow.
I mean, he's a wiener.
He kind of scowls at you again and starts walking back inside after fishing the cat out of the pool.
And he's holding like an imaginary pillow. You can't stop.
Plus 22 gold.
That's it, guys. You did it.
Yeah.
You did it.
We
you
did
succeeded
it.
In your adventure / temp job.
Woohoo!
Should we crash at Eugene's house one night and go back to the market tomorrow with the next?
He didn't tell you that you could stay there the night. He's probably not going to be thrilled about it, especially with her in the house, but yeah, that can happen.
I mean, I'll just hang out in the hot tub pool until it's time to get out.
You're going to turn into a prune.
Yeah. I'm going to sleep. I'm going to shoot.
That's it, guys. Do we have any more?
No.
Oh, we got to go on next week's.
Oh, yeah.
So, guys, thank you so much for watching. I was going to say, let's give a round of applause, but they won't hear it to our players.
I need
Carl Tart, Justin Michael, and Katie Cunningham. Great job, guys. Thanks for playing with us.
Thank you.
Do you guys have anything you want to plug?
Plug the white women, a group of my mom. We went to San Francisco Sketch Fest last week, and we got robbed. And there's a benefit show that we're having this Saturday night at the clubhouse at 7 p.m. Come check it out. We didn't put the thing on. It's created by this dude named Adam Driggers and some people on his team. They're really cool. But check out White Women Comedy on Twitter and UCB Hair All Night, UCB Mod Night.
Yeah. Just so everybody knows, if you're watching, you're not in Los Angeles, the stuff he's talking about, like the benefit show, is all real. It's very good cause. I think I'm doing a show on it, actually.
Yeah.
Great cause. But it's in Los Angeles. So if you're not there, think
fly
about
out.
Us.
Fly out.
But yeah,
fly
check out,
out.
The Twitter at White Women Comedy.
At White Women Comedy. At, right? At Swag Comedy.
At Swag Comedy.
At SWWAG Comedy.
They're Justin? Funny.
They're funny. It's true. I'm trying to think of things that are not in LA. Podcasts. I have a podcast called Before You Were Funny and another called Batman, the animated podcast. So listen to that if you like that.
Yeah, if you like Batman, it's an entire podcast discussing episode by episode Batman the Animated Series. I love it. It's great. It's amazing.
Ooh, thanks.
Check that out. Katie?
I have a Twitter, and my name's Katie Cunningham, and that's also my Twitter handle. So follow me at Katie Cunningham. I'm also on a lot of podcasts, but I will never host one. So you'll find them there.
That should go on your business card.
We'll never host a podcast.
But I'll always be a guest.
That's on the other side.
Yeah, it's all the fun with none of the work. I think that's it. Guys, if you want to vote on what adventure we're going to do next week, that poll should be up on the on jash.com/play right now. You can vote, and the two options for next week's adventure are either the Unsnuffed Torch
Wow.
or Revenge of the Dwarves.
Ooh.
Ooh. Wow.
Double wow, I'd say. World of WoWcraft.
So yeah, we'll play one of those next week. And if you want to hang out and watch, we're going to do a short little Q&A after. We're probably not going to be able to have it be quite as long as normal because there's another show filming in here after us. But yeah, are we doing TARDIS X dance?
We're still adjusting. Yeah.
It's very important we get this dance on film. But we're doing a little short Q&A. We'll answer some questions and interact with the chat room a little bit more than we're able to while we're playing. And otherwise, come back and watch us next week. We're normally at 3 p.m. every Thursday. Check out Jash.com and YouTube.com/Jash. And that's it. Thanks for watching, guys.